All praises to the Lord. So tonight's topic is called Enemy of the State. Enemy of the State. Tsietsi Mashinini. Tsietsi McDonald Mashinini. Enemy of the State. Okay, we're going to be going over the history of our brother, Tsietsi Mashinini. Okay, let's open up with the book of Exodus, chapter 33, verse 19. Let's start there. Okay, you know what? Give me Romans 15, verse 4. Let's open up with that. Romans 15, verse 4. Read that.
The book of Romans, chapter 15, verse 4.
Mm-hmm.
For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning.
Great.
Through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope.
Read that again.
The book of Romans, chapter 15, verse 4.
Mm-hmm.
For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning. That we, through patience and comfort of the scriptures, might have hope.
So the Most High God is letting us know here through the Apostle Paul that the things that were written aforetime, meaning in the past, were written for us to learn. This to going into history. The Lord is teaching us that we must be in tune with our history. When you read the history of our forefathers, they were always in tune with their history, unlike today. So we must understand, we must know our history, so that because history is bound to repeat itself. Our enemies know. They're our enemies because they study us. They study our history. They know the history of the 12 tribes of the nation of Israel, which today are called Bantus, Negroes, Tongas, Fairies, whatever they call us. You understand? Read that again, verse 4. Okay, come on.
The book of Romans, chapter 15, verse 4.
Read.
For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning.
Read.
That we, through patience and comfort of the scriptures, might have hope.
So we're only gonna find comfort in the scriptures. The things that are written, the Lord will give us comfort this day. Now watch this. I'm gonna take you back in the past. Give me Exodus 33, verse 19. Exodus 33, verse 19. Because our forefathers in the past, those that came and left, they left a mark on this planet Earth. They left a mark for us to learn from, that we may be able to do what? We may be inspired by their work. Tsietsi Mashinini is one of our forefathers that we must remember that brother. We must remember that great forefather that came in our time. Read what you got. Exodus 33, verse 19. Read.
The book of Exodus, chapter 33, verse 19.
Come on.
And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee.
Read.
And I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee.
Mm-hmm.
And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious.
I will be what?
And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious.
So the Lord says, he will make his goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious. The Lord is telling Moses, listen, I'm going to be gracious to whom I will be gracious to. Go ahead.
And will show mercy on whom I will show mercy.
He says, and I will show mercy to whom I will show mercy. Tsietsi Mashinini is one of those brothers. Don't get it twisted. They did not have the laws of God with them, but they had the spirit of the Lord on them. I'm going to show you that thing. Give me Job 32, verse 7. The Lord says he will be gracious to whom he will be gracious. He will show mercy to whom he will show mercy upon. Read that, Job 32, verse 7. He's only making reference to the 12 tribes of Israel. And Tsietsi Mashinini was an Israelite from the tribe of Judah. Read what you got, Job 32, verse 7. Come on.
The book of Job, chapter 32, verse 7.
Read.
I said, they should speak. Mm-hmm. And multiple years should teach wisdom.
You see, it says days should speak. So the days upon this earth, they should speak. And the multitude of our years upon this earth, they should teach us wisdom. Okay, come on.
But there is a spirit in man.
There's a what?
But there is a spirit in man.
But there's a spirit in man. There's a spirit in man. Come on.
And the inspiration of the Almighty giveth them understanding.
You see that thing? And the inspiration of the Almighty give the man that the Lord inspires understanding, to understand the condition of his people. Because our forefather Tsietsi Mashinini, he understood the condition of his people at 19 years old. He could already see the injustices that was going on around him. Understand that the spirit of the Lord was upon this brother. Read again. Okay. Verse 8. Come on.
The book of Job, chapter 32, verse 8.
Read.
But there is a spirit in man,
mm-hmm.
and the inspiration of the Almighty giveth them understanding.
The inspiration of the Almighty giveth them understanding. The Most High God is the one that inspired, that brother of ours, Tsietsi Mashinini. The Lord inspired him. Okay, watch this. Give me Job 33, verse 16. Okay, Job 33, verse 16. Read that.
The book of Job, chapter 33, verse 16.
Read.
Then he opened the ears of men and sealed their instruction.
You see what the Lord does? He opens the ears of men. He opens their spiritual ears to see, to hear the things that the people are complaining about, to hear the ills and the cry of the people. Read again, verse 16. Come on.
The book of Job, chapter 33, verse 16.
Mm-hmm.
Then he opened the ears of men and sealed their instruction.
Read again.
The book of Job, chapter 33, verse 16.
Mm-hmm.
Then he opened the ears of men and sealed their instruction.
The Lord will open the ears of men to seal his instruction in those men. You understand? For them to do the will of the Father. Read on, verse 17. Come on, watch this.
That he may withdraw man from his purpose.
That he may do what?
That he may withdraw man from his purpose.
That he may withdraw man from his purpose. You understand? That man must not do what he wants, but man will do what the Lord wants. Go ahead.
And hide pride from men.
Give me that in Proverbs 20, verse 24. Proverbs 20, verse 24. Watch this. Proverbs chapter 20, verse 24.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 20, verse 24.
Come on.
Man's goings are of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
How can a man then understand his own way?
You see that? Man's goings are of the Lord. How can a man then understand his way? Listen, everything that we do upon this earth, the Most High God has a say-so. You understand? Whatever it is that our forefather Tsietsi Mashinini did, the Lord had a say-so. He inspired that young man to do what? To wake up the 12 tribes of his heart. Because he saw the injustices of his people. He said, hell no. We need to fight. We need to defend our nation. We need to fight for our freedom. That's what he did. The Lord inspired him. Read again. Verse 24. Come on.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 20, verse 24.
Come on.
Man's goings are of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
How can a man then understand his own way?
Give me Proverbs 21, verse 1. Proverbs 21, verse 1. Read that.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 21, verse 1.
Come on.
The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
As the rivers of water, he turneth it whithersoever he will.
You see that thing? The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. Guess what? We are kings upon this earth. You understand? We are kings on this earth. The Lord is the one that directed our mind. He's the one that ever says so. Read.
Every way of man is right in his own eyes.
Mm-hmm.
But the Lord pondereth the hearts.
You see that every way of man is right in his own eyes. But the Most High God, he's the one that ponders the heart. Next verse. Come on.
To do justice and judgment is more acceptable.
Hold on. You see what the Lord put upon our forefathers? Tsietsi Mashinini. To do what now? Verse 3 again.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 21, verse 3.
Mm-hmm.
To do justice and judgment.
To do justice and judgment for his people. Because he saw the injustices that was done on the people when they were pushing Africans as a medium of instruction. He said, no, we're not going to accept that. You understand? So he saw the injustice. Guess what he did? He decided to do something about it. He stood up for the nation. Okay? Read again, verse 3. Come on.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 21, verse 3.
Mm-hmm.
To do justice and judgment is more acceptable to the Lord than sacrifice.
You see that thing? To do justice and judgment is more acceptable to the Lord than sacrifice. Now watch this. Because when he saw the injustices that was done, guess what happened? Hold this. Give me the book of Ecclesiastes 4, verse 1. Ecclesiastes 4, verse 1. I'm going to show you what the Lord did. Okay, because he saw the injustices of his people. Read that, because the Lord put the Spirit upon him to see that. Read it.
The book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 4, verse 1.
Read.
So I returned and considered all the oppressions that are done under the sun.
And that's exactly what he saw. He saw the oppressions that was done under the sun. The oppressions that was done to the people here in South Africa. He saw what the Buddhas was doing. He saw what the Dutchman was doing. He saw what the Afrikaners was doing upon our people, oppressing us with their language, forcing us to convert to their culture and customs. Okay, read again, verse 1.
The book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 4, verse 1.
Read.
So I returned and considered all the oppressions that are done under the sun.
Mm-hmm.
And behold, the tears of such as were oppressed.
You see that thing? Remember, he says he opened the ears of men. You understand? So he was able to hear, to see the tears of those that were oppressed. Go ahead.
And they had no comforter.
They had nobody to comfort them. Okay, come on.
And on the side of the oppressors, there was power.
On the side of the Buddhists, on the side of the Dutch, there was what?
And on the side of the oppressors, there was power.
On the side of the Buddhists that oppressed us here in South Africa, with Afrikaans, with killings, with lynchings, you understand? With gunshots. Guess what? There was power. But they had no what?
But they had no comforter.
But they had no comforter. You understand? So what did the Lord do? Give me Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 27. Here's what the Lord did. The Lord did this thing, okay? Because whenever there's, when you examine our history, whenever we find ourselves in the midst of oppression, in the midst of calamity, tribulations, and trials, when the nations have their foot on our neck, the Lord always sends saviors, okay? Tsietsi Mashinini was a savior. Understand that. Nehemiah 9, verse 27. Read it.
The book of Nehemiah, chapter 9, verse 27.
Come on.
Therefore, thou deliverest them into the hand of their enemies.
Because we were in the hands of our enemies. We still are. You understand? So in 1976, we were in the hands of our enemies. Okay? The Buddhists. We still are in the hands of our enemies right now. In South Africa. Go ahead.
Who vexed them?
They vexed us, you understand, with Kafirkans. That's why they said, away with Kafirkans, away. Because they vexed our people with that language. Read.
And in the time of their trouble.
In the time of their what?
And in the time of their trouble.
In the time of our trouble, what did the Lord do?
When they cried unto me.
Mm-hmm.
Thou heardest them from heaven.
Uh-huh. Go ahead.
And according to thy manifold mercies, thou gavest them saviors.
That's what the Most High God did. The Lord sent saviors. Whenever we find ourselves in trouble, the Lord always sent saviors. Joshua was a savior. Moses was a savior. Nehemiah was a savior. You understand? Ezekiel was a savior. Jeremiah was a savior. Christ, the Messiah, a savior. Okay? Guess who? Tsietsi Mashinini. He was one of the saviors. Okay? Read again verse 27.
The book of Nehemiah, chapter 9, verse 27.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore thou deliverest them into the hand of their enemies, who vexed them. And in the time of their trouble, when they cried unto thee, thou heardest them from heaven. And according to their manifold mercies, thou gavest them saviors.
You see that thing? According to the mercies of the Lord sent saviors, meaning leaders. The saviors goes into the leaders. The Lord rose up leaders to do what? Go ahead.
Who saved them out of the hand of their enemies.
Who saved them out of the hand of their enemies. Because back then, as a nation, we still knew we had enemies. Today, because of integration, you understand, because of the rainbow nation of Mandela, now we don't know who our enemies are. We have forgotten, you understand? But our forefathers, with the machine, they did not forget who their enemies are. And guess what? We must not forget who our enemies are. Understand that. The Most High God does not want us to forget our enemies because as a nation, we have enemies. And the enemies is all the nations outside of the 12 tribes of Israel. You understand? Watch this. Now, let's get a history on our forefathers. Let's understand our forefather, his mindset. Okay? Watch this. Now, I want you to read this. I want you to read. Do you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, read that thing for me. Come on.
Reading from sahistory.org.za.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Tebogo Tsietsi Mashinini.
Tebogo Tsietsi Mashinini. That's the brother right there. That's our forefather. You understand? Let's get a quick history right there. Read that.
First name, Tebogo. Last name, Mashinini.
Mm-hmm.
Date of birth, 27 January 1957.
Go ahead.
Location of birth, Central Western Chabavu, Soweto.
Go ahead.
Date of death, 1990.
Read.
Location of death, Guinea.
Mm-hmm. You are the male. Okay, now read that. Let's get some history of our forefathers. Read that for me. Come on.
Tsietsi Mashinini was born on 27 January 1957 in central western Jabavu, Soweto.
Mm-hmm.
Mashinini was the second son of Romutibi, a lay preacher in the Methodist Church, and Nomkita Mashinini, and was one of 13 children, 11 boys and twin girls.
Go ahead.
He was active in his local Methodist parish and chairperson of the Methodist Wesley Youth Guild at the age of 16.
Go ahead.
His education started at the Amajeli Creche in 1963.
Go ahead.
He went on to Seoding Lower Primary, after which he proceeded to Itsepeng Higher Primary.
Go ahead.
In 1971, he became a student at Morris Isaacson High.
Morris Isaacson High, that's where we were last week. That's where we were on the Sabbath day. Morris Isaacson. Okay, go ahead.
He was a passionate reader.
He was a what?
He was a passionate reader.
You see that thing? That's one of the, you see, leaders are readers. Let me say that again. Leaders are readers. He says he was a passionate reader. Go ahead.
This was spotted by his history and English teacher, Abraham Onkobotse Tiro.
So Abraham Onkobotse Tiro was his history and English teacher. Watch this. Go ahead.
Who taught that Morris Isaacson after was expelled from the University
of the North, Tefluop.
Mm-hmm. For his political activities.
So Abraham Onkobotse Tiro, he was a teacher, again, he was a history and English teacher that taught Tsietsi Mashinini. He was involved in political activities. What is that political activity? Go ahead.
Tiro had great influence in shaping Mashinini's political thinking and subsequent adherence to the ideology and philosophy of Black consciousness.
You see that thing? So Abraham Onkobotse Tiro, he actually taught Tsietsi Mashinini the way to think the way that he did. I want you to see something here. I'm going to show you something. Okay, go ahead.
He mentored him and supplied him with reading material.
Read that again. He did what?
He mentored him and supplied him with reading material.
You see that thing? Because he was a passionate reader. So guess what? He was mentored and he was supplied with reading material. Now watch this. Give me the book of Galatians chapter 4, verse 1. Galatians 4, verse 1. You know what? Before you get there, give me the book of Hebrews, chapter 5, verse 12. Hebrews 5, verse 12. I'm going to show you something here this day. Okay, come on.
The book of Hebrews, chapter 5, verse 12.
Go ahead.
For when for the time you ought to be teachers,
mm-hmm.
you have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God.
You see that thing? The first principles of the oracles of God is that you must be taught again. You understand? And guess what? Tsietsi Mashinini, he understood this. He understood this thing. Okay? Read that again, verse 12. Come on.
The book of Hebrews, chapter 5, verse 12.
Read.
For when for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again,
mm-hmm.
which be the first principles of the oracles of God.
Come on.
And have become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat.
So he needed the milk. He needed the foundation. You understand? To be able to do what what eventually was able to do, you understand, later on. Give me Galatians 4 verse 1 now. Galatians chapter 4 verse 1. Watch this.
The book of Galatians chapter 4 verse 1.
Read.
Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, mm-hmm. though he be Lord of all.
Read.
But is under tutors.
Lord of all, if there's a child who is an heir, he says he's not different from a servant, though he be Lord of all. Because eventually he ended up leading what? The Soweto student uprising. Okay. But guess what he needed for him to do that? Next verse. Come on.
But is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the Father.
Next verse. Read verse 2. Okay. Read Galatians 4 verse 1.
The book of Galatians chapter 4 verse 1. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, differeth nothing from a servant, though he be Lord of all,
is that the heir, as long as he's a child, is not different from a servant, though he be Lord of all. Go ahead.
But he's under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the father.
You see that thing? But he's under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the father. Because guess what Tsietsi Mashinini had? He had tutors. He had a mentor, mentoring him, grooming him, okay? Until the time appointed of the father to be able to do what he did, okay? Let's go back. Okay? I want you to read that again. It says, he was a passionate reader. This was spotted by his history and English teacher. Read that.
This was spotted by his history and English teacher, Abraham Nkhopotsediro,
mm-hmm.
who taught at Morris Isaacson after was expelled from the University of the North, Tuflo, for his political activities.
Go ahead.
Diro had great influence in shaping Mashinini's political thinking and subsequent adherence to the ideology and philosophy of black consciousness.
Go ahead.
He mentored him and supplied him with reading material.
He mentored Tsietsi and supplied him with reading material. That's what we're reading here. Read Galatians 4 verse 2 again.
The book of Galatians chapter 4 verse 2.
Read.
But is under tutors and governors until the time appointed of the father.
You see that thing? The reason why I made this young man exceptional was because he wasn't lazy. You understand? He wasn't a bum. Okay, he wasn't shiftless. He was a passionate reader. Because why? The Spirit of the Lord was on him to be able to see the condition of his people. You understand? And when he saw that, he said, listen, I'm going to do something about this thing. Watch this. Now, I'm going to show you something, right? Give me the book of Revelation 1 verse 3. Revelation 1 verse 3. Read that.
The book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse 3.
Come on.
Blessed is he that readeth.
You see that? Blessed is he that readeth. Blessed is he that readeth. So Tsietsi Mashinini says he was a passionate reader. You understand? The Lord was working with his brother. Read again. Verse 3. Read.
The book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse 3. Blessed is he that readeth.
Go ahead.
And they that hear the words of this prophecy.
And they do what?
And they that hear the words of this prophecy.
I want you to keep that in mind. And they that hear the words of this prophecy. The prophecies, now, when we read Deuteronomy 28, guess what? It's history. You understand? The majority of it has happened already. But that's part of the prophecy. You understand? Which is what? The testimonies of Christ. Read.
And keep those things which are written therein. For the time is at hand.
Now, watch this. Go back to... the part when he says he mentored him. Read that again.
He mentored him and supplied him with reading material.
Read.
Through Tiro, Mashinini started reading about the history of Africa's struggles.
Stop right there. Before we go any further, let's read about this brother, Abraham Ramotiri Nkhopotsediro. Read that.
Abraham Ramotiri Nkhopotsediro.
Let's read that synopsis.
Synopsis. Political activist, teacher, member of the South African Students Organization and Black Consciousness Movement. SASO's permanent organizer. Honorary president of the Southern African Students Movement. Exiled person, killed by a parcel bomb.
You see that? So whenever you saw black leader, whenever the white man, the Buddhists on this side of the earth, the Buddhists, who fan Niker, who fan Zay, who P3T, you understand? Paul Kruger and all of that, because those are all the same people, okay? Whenever they see a black leader rise up, guess what they do? They put them to death. But the Lord is raising 144,000 leaders. Understand that. They don't want to kill all of us. They are not going to kill all of us. Okay, go ahead.
First name Abraham, last name Diro. Date of birth, 9 November.
A beautiful name. Whoa. You see that part right there? His first name. Look at his first name. Abraham. Okay. Abraham, a father of many nations, the 12 tribes of Israel. Go ahead.
First name Abraham, last name Diro.
Mm-hmm.
Date of birth, 9 November, 1947.
Go ahead.
Date of death, 1 February 1974.
Okay, let's read a brief history about our brother. Okay, read that.
Abraham Nkgopotsi Ramotibi Tiro was born 9 November 1947 in Dinokana, a small village near Zeerust, Northwest Province, South Africa. Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
His parents, now late, were Nkokwe Peter and Moleseng Anna Tiro.
Read.
Tiro had two brothers and one sister. His mother was a domestic worker at Emerentia in Johannesburg, Transvaal, now Gauteng.
Go ahead.
Little is known about his father.
Go ahead.
His uncle, Ned Nkgopotsi Tiro, who he was named after, and Bafedile Masoba, his aunt, had a deep influence on his upbringing and sharpened his leadership skills.
You see that thing? Listen, look at that thing. You see, our forefathers and foremothers, guess what? They were completely in, guess what? They understood the importance of what? Of guiding. They understood the importance of teaching the children. They understood the importance of that. Unlike today when we raise our children with Facebook, Instagram, and TikTok, and Facebook. Go ahead.
Tiro spent time with his uncle, where he assisted him with the running of the bakery business.
He understood your business-minded too. Okay, read that.
He started his schooling in 1951 at the Ikalafeng Primary School. The school was closed down as a result of strikes against passes for women.
So that's the dumb part. Okay, read on.
This disrupted his studies.
Because guess what? This disruption right here is part of the reason why he was activated to do what? To go and fight for the nation of Israel, to fight for his people. Go ahead.
During the 5 months of disruption, he worked on a manganese mine for 75 cents per week as a dishwasher and general hand to raise funds to further his studies.
Read.
He attended Naledi High School in Soweto.
You see that? Where the uprising started. Remember when we're talking to our brothers on the ground, and the old brothers that was there during the time of Tsietsi Mashinini, they said basically the Soweto uprising started at Naledi High School and it moved on to Morris Isaacson. Okay, go ahead.
He attended Naledi High School in Soweto, Johannesburg, for 2 months, but was arrested for a pass offense.
Mm-hmm.
He then went to Barolong High School in Mafikeng, Northwest Province, where he matriculated.
Okay, go ahead.
After completing standard 10, now grade 12, he enrolled at Turfloop, now University of the North, really? For a degree in humanities. Here, he was elected president of the Student Representative Council, SRC, in his final year.
Really?
At the university's graduation ceremony in 1972, Tiro delivered a speech that sharply criticized the Bantu Education Act of 1953.
You see what he did? He was criticizing the Bantu Education Act. Watch this. Go ahead.
This later became known as the Turfloop Testimony.
You see what they codenamed it? The Turfloop Testimony. Read on.
Authorities at the university were angered by Tiro's outspokenness, and following the speech, Tiro was expelled from the university.
You see that thing? You see what happens when you stand up for truth? Because Bantu education, you know what is also called? Slave education. Just like Christianity. Christianity is a slave education, just like Bantu education was a slave education to keep black people on this side of the earth as slaves. And that's the same thing that Jan Hendrik Verwoerd said, the same thing. That Bantu education is designed to keep the black man in South Africa as a slave. That's what he said. That's what Verwoerd said. Okay? Read.
Despite demonstration by students under the new SRC, Tiro was not readmitted. One of his earlier encounters with the administration as SRC president was when they wanted expunged from the student diary two articles that they regarded as objectionable.
Objectionable. So they didn't like what he said. They didn't like that thing. Okay. Now, I just wanted to show you the type of character that this brother was. Hence why he was able to do what? To pour the same spirit in Tsietsi Mashinini. Now let's go back, okay? Let's go back right there. Let's go back. Now read that. It says, through Tiro, Mashinini did what? Read that.
Through Tiro, Mashinini started reading about the history of African struggles.
Stop right there. You see what he did? So he was influenced and mentored. Remember, it says he was a passionate reader, okay? So he started to read about the history of Africa's struggle. Not just South Africa, but the struggles that black people go through on the continent of Africa. You understand why? Because remember, at this time, the Berlin Conference has already taken place, where Otto von Bismarck and the 13 European nations, they came together to divide Africa into a piece of cake for themselves so that they can rob and spoil us of our land, our gold, our resources, you understand, and to get slave labor. So Tsietsi Mashinini, he understood this thing. Okay, Ray.
American slavery.
Yeah, he read about African struggle, which is what? Deuteronomy 28 verse 33, all that. We coming back. The struggle here on the continent. Okay, Deuteronomy 28 verse 33. Read that.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28 verse 33.
Read.
The fruit of thy land and all thy labors shall a nation which thou knowest not eat up.
Mm-hmm.
And thou shalt be only oppressed and crushed away.
You see that thing? So the history of Africa's struggle, he read about what? Colonization. He understood that the fruit of our land and all our labors, meaning we would work for the fruit of our land, shall another nation come and eat the fruit of our land. Following the Berlin Conference, you understand, in 1884, the Dutch, the French, the British, the Europeans, the Americans, the Spaniards, the Portuguese, they came and divided the continent up. Okay, go ahead. Because the Berlin Conference, they followed the conquest of David Livingstone in the 1700s. Read.
So that thou shalt be mad for the sight of thine eyes, which thou shalt see.
You see that thing? We're going to be mad for the sight of our eyes because we're going to see our enemy taking our land. We wouldn't have no power to do nothing about it. So he understood that. Okay? Read verse 43. Come on.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, verse 43.
Read.
The stranger that is within thee shall get up above thee very high.
The stranger that will get up above us very high is the same strangers that will come and take the fruit of our land. You understand? He's not talking about black people. He's talking about the other nations outside of us. The Dutch, the French, the British, the Portuguese, the Chinese, the Japanese, the Arabs. That's what he's talking about here. Go ahead.
And thou shalt come down very low.
We're going to be at the bottom. We are going to be impoverished. We're going to be cast in the cities and in the fields. Read.
He shall lend to thee.
They're gonna lend us money. They're going to borrow us money. Go ahead.
And thou shalt not lend to him.
We're not going to lend to them. Read.
He shall be the head, and thou shalt be the tail.
You see that thing? They're gonna run the economy. They're going to own the economy. You understand? They're going to control access to jobs and how much you get paid and where we live and how much we live for. How much we live by on a daily basis. They're going to control all that. You understand? They will divide us into lower class, middle class, and upper class. And the majority of us, we are on the lower class. We are basically below the poverty line. That's what the other nations would do. That will have power to take our land and our resources and leave us in an impoverished state. He understood this thing. He understood this. Okay? Go back. Through Tiro, read that.
Through Tiro, Mashinini started reading about the history of Africa's struggles.
He understood colonization and what happened. Okay? So he was reading about the struggles of his people. Read.
American slavery.
He read about the American slavery, which is what? The transatlantic slave trade. He read about that thing. Get that into Deuteronomy 28 now, verse 47.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, verse 47. Because thou servest not the Lord of thy God with joyfulness and with gladness of heart for the abundance of all things. Therefore... Okay,
wait. Read that again.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, verse 47. Because thou servest not the Lord thy God with joyfulness and with gladness of heart for the abundance of all things.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Therefore, shalt thou serve thine enemies, which the Lord shall send against thee, in hunger,
mm-hmm.
and in thirst, and in nakedness, and in want of all things.
Read.
And he shall put a yoke of iron upon thy neck, until he have destroyed thee.
So guess what? When he says he read about the history of American slavery, he understood where the slaves were coming from. The slaves were taken from the continent of Africa. He understood, these are my ancestors. These are my brothers and sisters, mothers and fathers, aunties and uncles. He understood that. That means he read about the transatlantic slave trade. You see that picture right there? You can see the picture, right?
Yes, sir.
That picture right there. So he saw, he read about this, what we see here. Yokes of iron on our forefathers' necks, like that right there. He saw this, okay? He read about this. He read about the transatlantic slave trade. Now read verse 68, okay? Come on.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, verse 68.
Read.
And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships.
The Lord will bring us into slavery again. Egypt is another name to mean slavery. Give me that in Deuteronomy chapter 8 now. Okay, Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 14. Read that.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 8, verse 14.
Read.
Then thine heart be lifted up, and thou forget the Lord thy God, which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt, from the house of bondage.
You see that thing? He brought us out of the land of Egypt, from the house of bondage. So go back to Deuteronomy 28 now, verse 68.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, verse 68.
Read.
And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships.
The Lord will bring us into the house of bondage again. But this time, we would go on cargo slave ships. That's what you've seen right there. These are the cargo slave ships. And these are our forefathers on the ships. You see how they are packed right there. You see across, vertical and horizontal and vertical. We are aligned. Look at that right there. The white men putting our forefathers on the ships. Our foremothers sitting there scared, okay? And this is how we were packed on ships, like sardines, like cargo, literally like cargo, okay? Read.
By the way whereof I spake unto thee,
mm-hmm.
thou shalt see it no more again.
Read.
And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies, for bondmen and bondwomen.
Slave men,
and no man shall buy.
Slave women, go ahead. And no man will deliver us out of this condition. He understood that. He read in the history books what happened to the so-called Negroes in the Americas. Because the Negroes, they are Bantus, okay? Negroes are Bantus. Understand that. He understood all that. It's only our people today who don't understand, who don't believe what we teach on the street. But that's their history, okay? Right there. This is what he understood. He saw the history of their so-called American Negro, okay? And he read the struggles of the Bantus on the continent of Africa. What he didn't know is that these were the Israelites from the tribe of Judah, and he was one of them, okay? He was one of them. He just didn't understand, he just didn't know that part. But he understood the prophecy, because why? He was a reader. He was a passionate reader, okay? Now, let's go back to the article, okay? We need to read that thing again. Now read it.
Through Tiro, Mashinini started reading about the history of Africa's struggles, American slavery, the human rights movements in the USA, and about the evil of apartheid.
Because the two are synonymous, remember? When the human rights movement was started in the US in the 60s, where, you understand, because of Jim Crow. Here in South Africa, these movements that we started, you understand, the Black Consciousness Movement, with the Tsietsi Mashinini rising, who Steve Biko rising, you understand, who Chris Hani rising up, and all that, was because of apartheid, the apartheid regime on this side of the earth. And apartheid was longer than Jim Crow even. You understand? Let's get there. The truth about apartheid. Hold on a second, okay? Right there. He read about Jim Crow on that side of the earth, and he read about the truth about apartheid right here from 1652, because in these latter days. You understand? He read about this. our foremothers in Rustenburg on the cotton fields and all that. You understand? In Rustenburg in the tobacco plantation, in Mpumalanga in the maize plantation. Kimberley, when our people were digging up gold, diamonds, and all that, you understand? Working in the farms, of which we don't own none of them. We don't own cotton and all that. He read about all that. Guess what? He also read about what? The Sharpeville massacre. Because this happened in the 1960s. You understand? The Soweto uprising was 1976. Okay, 16 years later. Okay. He didn't read about Marikana because it's recent. Okay. You understand? And this had not happened yet. This what we're looking at here. This has not taken place yet. All right. Now, I want you to read that again and finish it.
Through Tiro, Mashinini started reading about the history of Africa's struggles, American slavery, the human rights movements in the USA, and about the evil of apartheid.
Go ahead.
Mashinini was the chairperson of the debating team at his school, and his excellent academic performance became the basis for his influence among his peers.
You see that thing? He was able to influence others around him. Now watch this, watch this. Now what you need to understand is that, remember, he is reading about the struggle of the black man. He's starting to call, he saw, okay, why this is going on here now, during his time period, but his mentor, Abraham Nkopus, is like, no, I need to give you the big picture. I want you to go back to the history of where this thing come from. What's going on? What happened in the past? So you can see what's happening now. So he was what? He was able to show him the history of his forefathers. Very, very pertinent stuff. Watch this. Give me Deuteronomy 4, verse 27. Deuteronomy 4, verse 27. Let's read that.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 4, verse 27.
Go ahead.
Then the Lord shall scatter you among the nations, and you shall be left few in number among the heathen, whither the Lord shall lead thee.
You see that thing? So because Moses prophesied that we would be scattered among all nations on earth. We read by slave ships, through colonization, forced migration. You understand? So that's what the nations would do to us. Okay, jump down. Read verse 30 now. Come on.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 4, verse 30. When thou art in tribulation.
He was reading about the history of African struggle, American slavery, the human rights movement in the USA, and about the evil of apartheid. He was reading about all that, okay? When what thou art in tribulation, because during Tsietsi Mashinini's time, we were still in tribulation like we are now. You understand? So now the Lord is saying, when you are in tribulation, go ahead.
And all these things that come upon thee.
Apartheid. All these things that come upon thee, apartheid is one of those things that came upon us. Read.
Even in the latter days.
Even in the latter days, meaning in the last days. 1976 is also part of the last days. 2022 is part of the last days. You understand? During Tsietsi Mashinini's time, that was the time period of part of the last days. Read.
If thou turn to the Lord thy God, and shall be obedient unto his voice.
Because at this point, they didn't have the holy scriptures of the Lord with them yet. But the Lord had put the spirit upon them to see the condition of their people, to stand up to defend and deliver the people from oppression. That's what the Lord, that's the spirit the Lord put upon them. I'm going to prove that in the next verse. Next verse. Watch this. Come on. Verse 31. Come on.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 4, verse 31.
Read.
For the Lord thy God is a merciful God.
Stop right there. For the Lord thy God is a merciful God. Remember what you read in Exodus. Hold this. Give me that in Exodus 33 verse 19. We read it earlier. Okay. It says what? For the Lord thy God is a merciful God. Read that. Exodus.
The book of Exodus chapter 33 verse 19.
Go ahead.
And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee. And I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee.
Read.
And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious.
Come on.
And I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy.
You see that thing? He says, I'm going to show mercy on whom I will show mercy. Tsietsi Mashinini, the Lord showed mercy upon him for him to do what he did. The Lord showed mercy upon Nkopo the Tiro to do what he did. The Lord showed mercy upon our forefathers, who Steve Biko. He showed mercy upon them. You understand? He showed mercy upon Bukhisan. He showed mercy upon them. He poured his spirit upon them to wake the people up. Understand that thing. And they were radical. That's why the apartheid government didn't like them. That's why our people don't like people like Tsietsi, Mashinini. They don't talk about him. They don't show him on TV. You understand? On Villa Gazi Street, they don't talk about that brother. They don't talk about Tsietsi, Mashinini at all. Because during June 16th, they go to the Chapitazan Monument. They go to Mandela House. But they don't say nothing about Tsietsi, Mashinini. You understand? Those are the people the apartheid government hated with a passion. And guess what? Our people today, they don't talk about those brothers. We're going to talk about them. Read again.
The book of Exodus, chapter 33, verse 19.
Read.
And he said, I will make all my goodness pass before thee. Mm-hmm. And I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee.
Read.
And will be gracious to whom I will be gracious.
Mm-hmm.
And will show mercy on whom I will show mercy.
He says, I will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. Go back to Deuteronomy 4, verse 31 again.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 4, verse 31.
Read.
For the Lord thy God is a merciful God.
Mm-hmm.
He will not forsake thee, neither destroy thee.
Read.
Nor forget the covenant of thy fathers, which he sware unto them.
Mm-hmm. You see that thing? He did not forget the covenant he swore unto our forefathers. Go ahead. Next verse. Watch this. Come on.
For ask now of the days that are past.
All day. Read again. What?
For ask now of the days that are past.
It says now, it says because ask now of the days that are past. Remember what the Mashinini was doing? What Ngubuzo did, he mentored that young man. He mentored him to do what? To read about the struggle of his people. And he did that. He was a passionate leader. He understood history. He understood geopolitics. He understood how the world operated and who the enemy was. He understood that. He wasn't confused about that thing. That's why he had the type of spirit that he had. Read again. Verse 32.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 4, verse 32.
Mm-hmm.
For ask now the days that are past.
He says, ask now the days that are past. Hold that. Get Job 8 and 8. He says, ask now of the days that are past. Job chapter 8, verse 8. Read that.
The book of Job, chapter 8, verse 8.
Come on.
For inquire, I pray thee, of the former age.
Mm-hmm.
And prepare thyself to the search of their fathers.
You see, that thing is that we must inquire of the former age, of the days that are past. We must inquire, we must know our history. That's what the Lord is saying right there. Give me Deuteronomy 32, verse 7. Okay, come on.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 32, verse 7.
Read.
Remember the days of old.
Mm-hmm.
Consider the years of many generations.
Read.
Ask thy father, and he will show thee. Thy elders, and they will tell thee.
You see that thing? Remember the days of old. He says, ask now of the days that are past, of the former age. He's saying the same thing. The prophets are all saying the same thing. Okay, give me 1 Maccabees 2, verse 50. 1 Maccabees, chapter 2, verse 50. The Lord is saying, inquire of the former age, the past. You must know your history so you can understand how the enemy moves. The reason why our enemies are able to always have an upper hand is because they know our history. They study us. Okay? Read that. 1 Maccabees 2, verse 50.
First book of Maccabees, chapter 2, verse 50.
Go ahead.
Now, therefore, my sons, be ye zealous for the law,
mm-hmm.
and give your lives for the covenant of your fathers.
That's what our forefather Tsietsi did. Our Tsietsi Mashinini, he gave his life. And the brothers that he was fighting with, you understand, in the struggle with, they gave their lives for the people. Go ahead.
Call to remembrance what acts our fathers did in their time.
You see that thing? That's why we're going over the history of our forefather, Tsietsi Mashinini. We're calling to remembrance the acts that he did in his time. Read.
So shall you receive great honor and an everlasting name.
It's our job to make sure that our forefathers that came before us, that did great and mighty work, they receive an everlasting name. Our job is to do what? Is to remember those famous men. Is to exalt those famous men. Is to use them to inspire us for us to be able to do the same thing that they did in the spirit of Christ. Okay? Go back to where was that now? Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 32 again.
Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 32.
Go ahead.
For us now of the days that are past.
As now of the past, the former age, what our fathers did in their time. Go ahead.
Which were before thee,
mm-hmm.
since the day that God created man upon the earth.
You see what he said? Go all the way back to the beginning. Okay, read.
And ask from the one side of heaven unto the other,
mm-hmm.
whether there have been any such thing as this great thing is, or have been heard like it.
You see that in the great thing, that which is what? The greatest evil that is done upon a people upon the earth is known by everybody upon this earth. And when Tsietsi Mashinini was reading about this, he understood that. Give me Daniel 9 verse 11. He understood that thing. He understood it. That's why he was moving in the type of spirit that he was moving in. Because what? He was studying. He understood what happened in the past. He understood that. He did not just understand what was going on locally, but he understood what was going on across the continent. Because he understood that we are all suffering the same oppression. Ghana, Guinea, Morocco, you understand? Mozambique, okay? The Congo. He understood all that. Nigeria, that we all have the same enemy, which is who? The Dutch, the French, the British, the Portuguese, you understand? The Arabs, the Chinese, and the Japanese. Those are our enemies, God says. He understood all that. Okay, I'm going to show you later on. Daniel 9, verse 11. Read it.
The book of Daniel, chapter 9, verse 11. Verse 11.
Go ahead.
Yea, all Israel have transgressed thy law,
mm-hmm.
even by departing.
Come on.
That they might not obey thy voice. Therefore, the curse is poured upon us.
Read.
And the oath that is written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, because we have sinned against him.
Because the reason why these atrocities was happening to us, because we had broken God's commandments. We went against his order, the covenant that he made with us. Read.
And he hath confirmed his words, which he spake against us,
mm-hmm.
and against our judges that judged us,
read.
By bringing upon us a great evil.
What kind of evil?
By bringing upon us a great evil.
A great evil, a great evil, a great evil. That's the same thing that Moses said in Deuteronomy 4 verse 32. That look at from one end of heaven and onto the other, meaning on the whole earth. That this great thing that has taken place, it has not taken place on anybody else but the people of the book, which is us today. Go ahead.
For under the whole heaven hath not been done as hath been done upon Jerusalem.
Because guess what? Look at Tsietsi Mashinini revolted against what? With the students, they revolted against the use of kafir guns, right? But the level of response that they were met with it was unmatched. The students are protesting peacefully, unarmed, against a medium of instruction that we don't understand. But the response of the Buddhists was completely disproportionate, letting you know they knew something that many of us did not know back then. They knew something about us because our people, the nations, they read our book. They know who we are. They know the time for us. When we wake up, we're causing rau rau in the community. And that's what they were afraid of. That's why the reason why they responded. They responded the way that they did because it was deeper than that. Okay? Watch this. Now, let's go back to the article. Okay? Let's go back to the article. Now, let's see. Let me share my screen real quick. Okay? Let's read about this, Mike Smith. Okay? Read that. On the 13th of June. Read that.
On the 13th June, 1976,
mm-hmm.
about 500 Soweto students met at the Orlando Donaldson Community Hall to discuss ways and means of confronting and challenging the Department of Bantu Education.
You see that thing of the means of challenging the Department of Bantu Education, meaning the Department of Slave Education. That's what Bantu Education was, slave education, you understand? Because that's the same thing that Tsietsi Mashinini, his teacher, he was writing about, which got him expelled at the university. Read that again, okay?
At the university's graduation ceremony in 1972, Diro delivered a speech that sharply criticized the Bantu Education Act of 1953.
You see that thing? He criticized the Bantu Education Act of 1953. This is 1972. Now, in On the 13th of June 1976, guess what? After mentoring Tsietsi Mashinini, look what Tsietsi Mashinini is taking it to the next level. You see that thing? Read it again, that paragraph.
On 13th June 1976, about 500 Soweto students met at the Orlando Donaldson Community Hall to discuss ways and means of confronting and challenging the Department of Bantu Education.
Right. Let me share my screen real quick. So let's see. Read that.
Bantu education and the racist compartmentalizing of education.
Okay, Bantu education and the racist compartmentalizing of education. Read that.
In 1949, the government appointed the Aselin Commission with the task of considering African education provision.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
The commission recommended resorting to radical measures for the effective reform of the Bantu school system.
You see that thing? They wanted to change the Bantu school system because the way we were taught, our forefathers, the teachers back then, they still taught us values and morals. They taught us about our history. So they needed to change all that. Okay, go ahead, watch this. Read.
In 1953, prior to the apartheid government's Bantu Education Act,
mm-hmm.
90% of Black South African schools were state-aided mission schools.
Read.
The act demanded that all such schools register with the state and removed control of African education from the churches and provincial authorities.
You see what they were doing? They were removing any trace of our history because they did not know what was being taught at those schools. Read.
This control was centralized in the Bantu Education Department,
mm-hmm.
a body dedicated to keeping it separate and inferior.
You see what they were doing? Their job was to make sure that we get the poor education as much as possible. That's why today our people go to universities and all that, but they cannot do nothing with those degrees. Guess what? The Bantu education that was put together under the Excellent Commission is still inactive today. Don't get it twisted. Read on.
Almost all the mission schools closed down.
Mm-hmm.
The Roman Catholic Church was largely alone in its attempt to keep its schools going without state aid.
Because these ones, the Romans, they were teaching us white Jesus. Read on.
The 1953 Act also separated the financing of education for Africans from general state spending and linked it to direct tax paid by Africans themselves.
You see that thing? Now they're imposing tax on us. Go ahead.
With the result that far less was spent on Black children than on white children.
That's the same thing. It's still going on today. Okay, let's see. There's something I want. Let's see, hopefully it will open up here. I really did not want to go into this. I really didn't want to go into this now, not today. But the whole point of the Bantu education was a slave education. That's the point. The Bantu education is a slave education. Okay, go back. Read that. On the 13th of June, read that.
On the 13th of June, 1976,
mm-hmm.
about 500 Soweto students met at the Orlando Donaldson Community Hall to discuss ways and means of confronting and challenging the Department of Bantu Education.
They wanted to challenge the Department of Bantu Education. If somebody can find a part where it talks about where they were saying the Bantu education objective was to keep the Black man as a slave, you understand, as a servant. To maintain servant and master and servant. Somebody find me there. Okay, go ahead.
The students decided to stage a peaceful protest march on 16 June against the introduction of Afrikaans as a medium of instruction.
Because this was the center point of why Tsietsi Mashinini gathered the students together to go and protest against the use of Afrikaans. This is what started the Soweto uprising, okay? Remember, this is on the 13th of June, okay? Read that part again. The students did what?
The students decided to stage a peaceful protest march on 16th June against the introduction of Afrikaans as a medium of instruction.
You see that thing? So now, watch this. Give me the book. Give me the book of Habakkuk. Okay, give me Habakkuk 3. I'm going to show you something. It says, they staged a peaceful protest. They were unarmed. They staged a peaceful protest. Watch this. Habakkuk 3, read verse 14. Watch this.
The book of Habakkuk, chapter 3, verse 14.
You know what? Hold on. No. Yeah. Read that. Let's just read it. Come on.
Thou didst strike through with his staves the head of his villages.
The head of the villages, we talk about the white man. He's the head of all the nations on this earth that are working together to destroy us. Go ahead.
They came out as a whirlwind to scatter me.
Mm-hmm. Meaning Christ. Read.
Their rejoicing was to devour the poor secretly.
Their rejoicing was as to devour the poor secretly. Because understand, the nations, their job is to devour secrets, meaning what? They don't do it in your face. You understand? They implement 50-50 in the household. They implement black women empowerment. They implement women wearing pants, the feminist movement. You understand? They're pushing homosexuality in our community. They're giving us poor education, poor housing, poor medical, whatever. And everything is poor, poor, poor. You understand? They make sure that they keep us at the bottom. They destroy our history. And the history that they teach us is to glorify their forefathers for conquering us. That's what we know about Jan van Riebeck. That's what we know about Napoleon. You understand? We know about them because they pushed their forefathers on us that conquered us and destroyed us. That's what they did. That's so their desire is to destroy us secretly. Okay? Give me the book of Isaiah 32, verse 7.
Of Isaiah chapter 32 verse 7.
Read.
The instruments also of the churl are evil.
Like giving us what? Giving us forcing Africans as a medium of instruction upon us. Hence the protest. Read.
He devises wicked devices, destroy the poor with lying words.
Destroy the poor with lying words because they always lie. Go ahead.
Even when the needy speaketh right.
Even when our people were peacefully protesting against the use of Afrikaans as a medium of instruction. Even when the needy speaketh right. Who was the needy? Tsietsi, Mashinini, and those 520,000 plus students that marched on that day. Okay? Now, read that again. The students decided to do what?
The students decided to stage a peaceful protest march on 16 June against the introduction of Afrikaans as a medium of instruction.
You see that thing? So they were enforcing Afrikaans as a medium of instruction. Now watch this. Give me the book of Deuteronomy 20, verse 49. Okay, because as part of the curses of Deuteronomy 20, as part of God's judgment, the nations that will come upon us, they will force their languages upon us. Get that? Deuteronomy 20, verse 49.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, verse 49.
Read.
The Lord shall bring a nation against thee from far,
mm-hmm.
from the end of the earth, as swift as the eagle flieth.
You know,
a nation.
It says, a nation against us from far. Remember, your Jan van Riebeck and his boys, you understand? They're coming from Dutch, the Netherlands, and all that, the Boers. Guess what? That's the nation that came against us from far. 1652. Okay? As swift as the eagle flies, because an eagle is a bird of prey, they devour the prey. So guess what? That's the spirit that this white man had. And also, his symbol is the symbol of the eagle. Okay, go ahead.
From the end of the earth, as swift as the eagle flies,
mm-hmm.
a nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand.
You see that thing? A nation whose tongue we will not understand. Because what were they teaching? Go back to the article. Read that again. The students did what?
The students decided to stage a peaceful protest march on 16 June against the introduction of Afrikaans as a medium of instruction.
You see that thing? So that Afrikaans as a medium of instruction, guess what? That's what the Lord is saying here. A nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand, because our people did not understand Afrikaans. But the Boers were forcing Afrikaans on us. Even at the jobs today, 2022, they still speak Afrikaans among themselves, even when they are not next to us. But when we speak ours, they feel uncomfortable. You cannot make this up. You understand? Go ahead.
An action committee was set up to prepare for the campaign.
Okay, all that. Go back. Deuteronomy 28, read verse 50 again. Read verse 50 now.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, verse 50.
Mm-hmm.
A nation of fierce countenance, which shall not regard the person of the old, nor show favor to the young.
So now it says a nation of fierce countenance, meaning what? They don't give a damn about nobody, but the agenda that they have, which is to conquer and colonize and make sure that everybody assimilates into their culture. That's what the Greeks did. That's what the Romans did. That's why they're saying during the time we were slaves in Rome, they say, when you get to Rome, do what the Romans do. You understand? Our forefathers that have assimilated to Roman culture. You understand? So the Buddhists, which is the same people, they were doing the same thing here, forcing Africans upon us. Okay? Now, just back to the article. An action based on what, you know what? You see, this thing of forcing a language upon us is not during the time of apartheid. It happened even in the past. I'm going to show you that. Give me the book of Daniel 1 verse 4. Daniel. Because during the time of Daniel, we were staying under the Babylonians, the Nilotic Kushites, the Nilotic Ethiopians. Okay? Read that. Daniel 1 verse 4.
The book of Daniel, you know, chapter
4. Start of verse 1.
The book of Daniel chapter 1 verse 1.
Mm-hmm.
In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem and besieged it.
So now this is around 626 BC. This is Nebuchadnezzar came against us and besieged the city. Jump down to verse 4 now. Watch this.
The book of Daniel chapter 1 verse 4.
Mm-hmm.
Children in whom was no blemish,
mm-hmm.
but well favored and skillful in all wisdom, and cunning in knowledge, and understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace.
Okay.
And whom they might teach the learning of the tongue of the Chaldeans.
See that part right there? Whom they might teach the learning and tongue of the Chaldeans. Guess what? They taught us their tongue, the Chaldean tongue that they spoke during those days. You understand? We were slaves under Nebuchadnezzar. They forced their language upon us also during this time. Give me the book of 2 Maccabees 6, verse 6. This is now, we're going to the time of the Greeks. 2 Maccabees 6, verse 6. Watch this.
2 book of Maccabees, chapter 6, verse 6.
Mm-hmm.
Neither was it lawful for a man to keep Sabbath days or ancient feasts,
mm-hmm.
or to profess himself at all to be a Jew.
So under the Greeks, we were not allowed to celebrate our ancient high holidays that the Lord gave unto us. You understand? Not only that, we were not allowed to profess ourselves that we were the Jews of the Bible. So the Greeks, they changed our nationality. Then the change of our nationality started with the Greeks. Not only did they change our nationality, you understand? Read verse 8 now. Okay, read.
Second book of Maccabees, chapter 6, verse 8.
Read.
Moreover, there went out a decree to the neighbor cities of the heathen,
mm-hmm.
by the suggestion of Ptolemy against the Jews.
So now the decree is a what? Is a mandate, is an executive order. That's what the Buddhists did during with the Bantu Education Act. As part of that was to make Africans as a medium of instruction. So they put out a decree. So the Bezalel, I need you to send me the picture that we took when we were in Soweto, the picture where we were standing, where they were showing the picture, the multiple pictures of Tsietsi Mashinini, okay? And they were showing the decree that was given by the Buddhists during that time, okay? Send it to me on WhatsApp.
Yes, sir.
Okay, read verse 8 again.
Second book of Maccabees, chapter 6, verse 8.
Mm-hmm.
Moreover, there went out a decree to the neighbor cities of the heathen by the suggestion of Ptolemy against the Jews, that they should observe the that they should observe the same fashions and be partakers of their sacrifices.
You see that thing? So now the decree that was put out by Ptolemy, who was a Greek, okay, guess what? That's the same thing that the Buddhists did when they came on this side. They did the same thing that our forefathers did during the time of the Greeks when we were slaves unto them. They put out a decree, you understand, that against us, that we should observe the same fashions, meaning we should observe their culture, their customs, and they forced their own languages upon us and be partakers of their sacrifice. Meaning what? Birthdays, Mother's Day, Father's Day, Valentine's Day, Christmas, so on and so forth. Read on, verse 9.
Verse 9. Mm-hmm. And whoso would not conform themselves to the manners of the Gentiles should be put to death.
You see what they were doing? They were killing us. And I'm going to show you, because that's what the Buddhists did. They opened fire on what? A peaceful protest of the students. That's the same thing the Greeks did. That's the same thing that the Buddhists did, which is the same people. They call themselves Buddhists, Dutch, whatever, English, you know. They are all the children of Esau, Edom, Idumea. Read again, verse 9.
Second book of Maccabees, chapter 6, verse 9.
Read.
And whoso would not conform themselves to the manners of the Gentiles should be put to death.
You see that thing? When we did not conform, we said, away with Africans, away. Away with Africans, away. What did they say? They should what? What should happen to us?
And whoso would not conform themselves to the manners of the Gentiles should be put to death.
You see that thing? If we do not conform to the manners of the Gentiles, they put us to death. You understand? And guess what? During Africans, during the apartheid, when they were putting Africans on us, that's exactly what they did. They killed unarmed students. You understand? Now, let me open that up so I can blow it up so we can see. Let me blow this big. Okay, do you see the picture?
Yes, sir.
Okay, let's see now if you can see. Let me see if I can blow it up some more. Hopefully we can see it. That's our brother right there. Tsietsi, Mashinini. Okay, away with Baride. What did it say?
Away with Bantu education.
Away with Bantu education. Okay, so that's what it said. Let's read that. Read that. This is what Tsietsi, Mashinini said. Read it.
If you're not doing what the government expects you to do, then you are a communist, of course.
Then you are a communist, of course. Okay. Let's see. Yes, read that. How come? Read how long? Read that.
How long must we be bullied, kicked, choked?
I don't know what that is, but it says, how long must we be bullied, kicked, choked, and killed? I can't see that last part, but it says, and killed. Okay, let's see. Yeah, it's just that it's not visible, okay? But when we're standing next to it, we could see that. But read that. Away with what?
Away with Bantu education.
Away with Bantu education. Remember, as part of Bantu education, guess what they were going to do? They were enforcing Africans upon us. You understand? Let's see. Let's get some more. So what you're seeing here is just that you can't see because, you know, it's too blurry. But this picture right here, what you see here, this thing right here was the decree, the mandate, the executive order that they passed, that Africans was going to be the medium of instruction. When you're standing next to it, it actually explained that somewhere right here. It explains that, okay? So, read that again. Second Maccabees 6, read 8 and 9 together again.
Second book of Maccabees, chapter 6, verse 8.
Read.
Moreover, there went out a decree to the neighbor cities of the heathen,
mm-hmm.
by the suggestion of Ptolemy against the Jews.
Read.
That they should observe the same fashions and be partakers of their sacrifices.
Read.
And whoso would not conform themselves to the manners of the Gentiles should be put to death. Then might a man have seen the present misery.
So this is the misery, this picture that you just saw, that I showed, that was the present misery that was going on during that time. When our forefathers, with the Mashinini, the students were fighting, you understand, against this thing. Okay, let me show the picture again so you can see. Right there, right there. This is where we were standing. I was with Soldier Bezalel when we came here, okay, to see the history of what was going on during that time. Okay, this right here. All right. So that's what you are seeing here. Okay, what the machine was talking about. Now, let's go back to the article. Okay, let's go back to the article. Let's read some more. Let's continue to read. All right. Now read that. Action committee was then what? Read that.
An action committee was set up to prepare for the campaign.
Mm-hmm.
Mashinini was elected chairperson of the action committee, which was later renamed the Soweto Students Representative Council,
mm-hmm.
with Mashinini as its first president, until he was succeeded by Khotso Siyatlolo.
So Khotso Siyatlolo succeeded him. He was from Naledi High School. Remember, when we're talking to the people on the ground, they said what? They said the uprising started at Naledi High School and it moved over to Morris Isaacson, right? That's what they said when we're talking to the people on the ground. Okay, go ahead.
Mashinini and Murphy Murobe were the two representatives from Morris Isaacson High School serving in the Soweto Student Representative Council.
So now they understood, they formed an organization, a body, for them to be able to organize, for them to be able to be on one mind and one accord. So they had enough sense to do that. Go ahead.
During assembly on the morning of 16 June at Morris Isaacson High School, Mashinini climbed onto the podium and led students into song and out of the school grounds towards the assembly point for the planned student demonstration.
So they were planned to demonstrate their grievances, you understand? To rally everybody up, and guess what? They all understood who the enemy was. They were not confused about this thing, unlike us today. Go ahead.
They were joined by students from other schools in Soweto.
Mm-hmm.
It is estimated that 20,000 uniformed students joined the mass demonstration.
You see that thing? They joined 20,000 plus. Go ahead.
As they marched down in a throng, they came across a police barricade on their way to the assembly point.
So now, hold on. Remember, it was a peaceful protest, right? It says they were what? They came across a police barricade on their way to the assembly point. A police barricade comes with what? They come with guns. They come armed. Remember, these are students. They are not armed. They are singing, you understand? Power to the people. That's what they were doing. They had no guns on them. Read on.
Mashinini climbed a makeshift podium to deliver a spirited address, telling students to march peacefully, to remain orderly, and not to provoke the police.
You see what he told them? So he said, listen, this is a peaceful protest. Don't provoke the police. Remain in order. They were well ordered. Go ahead.
The horrific events of that day, which saw the South African police shoot live bullets at peacefully protesting students, turned him into an instant hero and an activist of national importance.
Read that again. Come on.
The horrific events of that day, which saw the South African police shoot live bullets at peacefully protesting students, turned him into an instant hero and an activist of national importance.
You see what the police did? Is that the horrific events of that day, we saw the South African police shoot live bullets at peacefully protesting students. Watch this. I'm going to show you something, because in order for them to be able to rally up 510 into 20,000 plus, they were all in the same mind. Why? Because they understood who the enemy was. Give me Nehemiah 5 verse 9. Nehemiah chapter 5 verse 9. They understood the enemy. Because of integration and the Rainbow Nation of Nelson Mandela, our people today are bugged out. That's why when we went to teach at Vilakazi Street, guess what the black woman said? The black woman said, when we're teaching that Jesus is a black man, you know what she said? She said, we are teaching apartheid. You cannot make this up. Even when white people were saying, yes, indeed he's black, the black woman was not saying, no, 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 don't teach that. That's apartheid. You cannot make this up. Read what you got, Nehemiah 5 verse 9.
The book of Nehemiah, chapter 5 verse 9.
Go ahead.
Also, I said, it is not good that you do.
Mm-hmm.
Or do not walk in the fear of our God because of the reproach of the heathen, our enemies.
You see that thing? It says, or do not to walk in the fear of God because of the reproach of the heathen, our enemies. With Tsietsi Mashinini and those 20 plus students and the rest of the families that joined in, they understood who the enemy was. You understand? Their enemy was not their own brother. The enemy was the Buddhist and they understood that. There was no confusion. Today we confused. Watch this. Give me the book of Zacharias, okay? Zechariah chapter 11, verse 5. Zechariah chapter 11 and verse 5. Because you know what? Give me the book of Zephaniah 2, verse 1. I'm going to show you something. Because with the Mashinini, they understood the power of unity. They understood that. They understood that thing because people were literally dropping dead. Read what you got. Zephaniah 2, verse 1.
The book of Zephaniah, chapter 2, verse 1.
Read.
Gather yourselves together. Gather together, O nation not desired.
With the Mashinini, they understood that we are a nation that is not desired. And we as a people, we have enemies. So it was necessary that we are on the same page. There was necessary that everybody understood why they were there. Get that in 1 Corinthians 1 verse 10.
First book of Corinthians, chapter 1 verse 10.
Go ahead.
Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing.
You see that thing? With the Mashinini and the rest of the students, they all spoke the same thing. Away with Africans, away. They understood that. They understood the mission. Read.
And that there be no divisions among you.
That there were no divisions among them. Because they understood who the enemy was. And Tsietsi Mashinini, he was a reader. So he understood the history of the oppression of his people. Read.
But that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment.
And they were all perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. You understand? They understood that. They understood it. Now, read that part again when it says the horrific events. Read that again.
The horrific events of that day, which saw the South African police shoot live bullets at peacefully protesting students, turned him into an instant hero and an activist of national importance.
So now, you see this thing right here? It says, they saw police shoot live bullets at peacefully protesting unarmed students. You understand? That's what happened. Go ahead.
He stood steadfast against state harassment and imminent arrest.
He did what?
He stood steadfast against state harassment and imminent arrest.
He said he stood steadfast. Let's get the definition of steadfast. Let's get the definition of steadfast. Heavy stuff. Now read that. The definition of steadfast.
Definition of steadfast. Adjective.
Go ahead.
Resolutely or dutifully firm and unwavering.
You see that thing? He was resolutely and dutifully firm and unwavering. He did not waver. He understood the mission. Okay, go ahead.
Similar. Loyal.
He was loyal. Go ahead.
Faithful.
He was loyal, faithful to the cause, to the mission. Read.
Committed.
He was committed to the mission. Read.
Devoted. Dedicated.
Go ahead.
Dependable.
He was dependable. Come on.
Reliable.
He was a reliable brother. Go ahead.
Steady.
Steady. Read.
True.
He was not a fakester. Go ahead.
Constant.
He was constant. Constant. Read.
Trusty.
Trusty. Go ahead.
Determined.
Determined. Read.
Relentless.
Go ahead.
Single-minded.
Come on.
Unchanging. Unwavering.
Go ahead.
Unhesitating.
Come on.
Unfaltering.
This is the character of this machine. Go ahead.
Unswerving.
Read.
Unyielding.
Come on.
Unflinching. Inflexible.
Come on.
Uncompromising.
This is the character of our forefather, this machine. Give me that in Sirach chapter 5. Okay. Ecclesiastes chapter 5. Read Sirach 5 and verse 10.
The book of Ecclesiastes chapter 5 verse 10.
Read.
Be steadfast in thy understanding.
The Tsietsi machine was steadfast in the understanding, the mission, and the duty that he had to perform for the benefit of his nation. Read.
And let thy word be the same.
Be uncompromising, unswerving, unfaltering, unhesitating, unwavering, single-minded, unchanging, inflexible. Because why? He was disciplined on the mission. Okay. Now, let's go back. Read that part again.
He stood steadfast against state harassment and imminent arrest, issuing press statements and calling for students to boycott classes, and wrote critically of the police's actions on 16 June that saw innocent students massacred.
You see that thing? So the Soweto massacre, because it was a massacre. You understand? On June 16, he saw innocent students massacred. Remember, it says it was 20,500 plus students that was there protesting against Afrikaans or Afrikaans, because that's what they call it. Okay, now watch this. Give me the book of Zechariah, chapter 11, verse 5. Zechariah, because we need to deal with the people that shot at innocent students with live bullets when they were protesting peacefully and they were unarmed. Read that.
The book of Zechariah, chapter 11, verse 5.
You know what? Hold on. Watch this. I'm going to deal with that when it says the peaceful, innocent students. Give me Luke 10, verse 3. Luke 10, verse 3. Watch this.
The book of Luke, chapter 10, verse 3.
Go ahead.
Go your ways. Behold, I send you forth as lambs among wolves.
You see that thing? That's exactly what happened. There were lambs among wolves because they were innocent. They were protesting peacefully. They were ordered not to provoke the police, and they did not provoke the police. The police, the way they responded, it was disproportionate to what the student was doing. You understand? Give me Matthew 10, verse 16. Matthew chapter 10, verse 6. We need to understand the characteristics of our enemies, okay? What happened in June 16? The massacre. Go ahead.
The book of Matthew, chapter 10, verse 15.
One six.
Verse 16.
Mm-hmm.
Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves.
You see that thing? That's what Tsietsi Mashinini ordered the people. I will send you as sheep in the midst of wolves. You order them, listen, it's a peaceful protest. That's exactly what they did. That's the same thing that happened during the 21st of March 1960. You understand? When Robert Sobukwe and them, you understand, with Steve Biko and all, they were protesting against, listen, we don't want to use the dumpers to be able to travel to different neighborhoods and all that. Guess what? They opened fire on them too. The same thing. 16 years later, the same thing took place. Go ahead.
Be therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves.
Peaceful protest. Be therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves. And that's exactly the students were. The students were harmless as doves. Give me Zechariah chapter 11, verse 3.
The book of Zechariah, chapter 11, verse 3.
Go ahead.
There is a voice of the howling of the shepherds.
You see that thing? The voice of the howling of the shepherds. We the shepherds, the saviors, the leaders. Go ahead.
For their glory is spoiled.
Because our glory, the glory of the people is spoiled. We are spoiled by the philosophies and culture and customs of these other nations. Read.
A voice of the roaring of young lions.
A voice of the roaring of young lions. So Tsietsi Mashinini and those brothers, those were young lions. Go ahead.
For the pride of Jordan is spoiled.
Because the pride of our people was spoiled, meaning what? Our glory was destroyed. Watch this. Go ahead.
Thus said the Lord my God, feed the flock of the slaughter.
That's what Tsietsi Mashinini did. He fed the flock. He rallied the students up to say, listen, we need to fight for our freedom. That's what he did. The Spirit of Christ was working with us, brother. Understand that thing. But guess what? When we came as sheep, guess what? How they responded. Read verse 5 now. Watch this.
Whose possessors slay them?
They do what?
Whose possessors slay them?
They are our possessors, meaning our oppressors, the Buddhists during that time, they slain us. They killed our people in cold blood. Hold this. Give me Leviticus 26, 17. Leviticus chapter 26, verse 17. Whose possessors slay them? Okay. Read that.
The book of Leviticus, chapter 26, verse 17.
Read.
And I will set my face against you, and you shall be slain before your enemies.
Mm-hmm.
They that hate you shall reign over you.
They that hate us will rule over us. So read that again, verse 16. Let me catch it.
The book of Leviticus, chapter 26, verse 17.
Mm-hmm.
And I will set my face against you, and you shall be slain before your enemies.
Read.
They that hate you shall reign over you.
You see that thing? So now what we're reading here, the Most High God is saying, it says what? And ye shall be slain before your enemies. Because guess what? It says, whose possessors slay them? Who slain us? Our enemies is our possessors. Our enemies is our oppressors. They cannot be our saviors. You see that? Our enemies is those that possess us, those that own us, those that are ruling over us and oppressing us. Guess what? They kill and destroy us, okay? That's what the Lord is telling us, that's what will happen to us. And they will rule over us. Go ahead.
And ye shall flee when none pursueth you.
If you see that thing, we fled. Because what was pursuing us? It was not them, it was their bullet. Their bullet was pursuing us. Go back to Zechariah 11, verse 5.
The book of Zechariah, chapter 11, verse 5.
Read.
Whose possessors slay them and hold themselves not guilty.
You see that thing? And they held themselves not guilty. Because they've never paid for their crimes. That's why they hold themselves not guilty. Read.
And they that sell them say, blessed be the Lord, for I am rich.
Mm.
And their own shepherds pity them not.
You see what the Bible is saying? And they that sell them say, because who sold us into slavery? The nations, they sold us into slavery. Give me the book of Nahum 3. The nations, they sold us into slavery during the transatlantic. The slave trade, the transatlantic slave trade, the Silk Road, when the Chinese and the Japanese and the Arabs went together to sell us to China. You understand? Nahum 3, read verse 10.
The book of Nahum, chapter 3, verse 10.
Go ahead.
Yet was she carried away. She went into captivity.
Mm-hmm.
Her young children also were dashed in pieces at the top of all the streets.
That's what happened during the Soweto Massacre of 1936. The young children, which is the students, it says what? Also were dashed in pieces at the top of all the streets. The police, the Buddhists, they opened fire on unarmed young students. You understand? And dashed in pieces at the top of the streets. Let's see. Did that happen? Of course it happened. Look at that. Young children being put to death. Look at that. Young children during the Soweto massacre. Look at that. Three white men going after a young boy. Look at that thing right there. A nation of fierce countenance who will know, they're not going to give a damn about the young or the old. And that's what you see right here. Okay, that's our brother Mbuizeni. Okay, carrying Hector Peterson and our sister right there. Look at the young man. Being dragged on the floor like dogs. You understand? Read that again.
The book of Nahum, chapter 3, verse 10.
Mm-hmm.
Yet was she carried away. She went into captivity. Her young children also were dashed in pieces at the top of all the streets.
Read.
And they cast lots for her honor, for her honorable men.
They cast lots for her honorable men, meaning the leaders of our people, they were casting lots for them. Meaning what? They were what? They were auctioning our forefathers and foremothers with their children and sons and daughters. Read.
And all her great men were bound in chains.
Meaning what? They put chains on our necks, our ankles, and our feet. Okay, go back. Zechariah chapter 11. Read verse 5 again.
The book of Zechariah, chapter 11, verse 5.
Read.
Whose possessors slay them and hold themselves not guilty.
Mm-hmm.
And they that sell them say, blessed be the Lord, so for I am rich.
The white man that sold us into slavery, the Chinese, the Arabs, the Portuguese, the French, the British, the Americans, they said, blessed be the Lord, for I am rich. They've gotten rich by selling our forefathers and foremothers and our children into slavery, colonizing us, pushing us into the ghettos, you understand? Creating Bantu education and putting us into Bantu stand. Today they are called Lokshens and Kasis. Go ahead.
And their own shepherds pity them not.
You see that? And their own shepherds pity them not. Who's that talking about? The so-called black leaders today. Is that their own shepherds pity them not? I'll give an example. When you look at the monument of Hector Peterson, right? You look at Vilagazi Street. The streets are clean, is well taken care of. Go to where the empty Mashinini statue is, because we were there. It's filthy. It's full of garbage. That place is not maintained. You understand? You can see that that place is dead. They don't give a damn about that place. They don't give a damn about that brother, they don't give a damn. I'm telling you right now, because when I saw that, really, that thing really vexed my spirit, man. You understand? I'm like, this great leader, look at how he's seated. It's like he's never been born. It's like nobody remember him. Because I remember last year when we were teaching at Vilagazi Street to teach our people on June 16th, I was asking the children, who's Tsietsi Mashinini? They did not know who he was. They didn't know Tsietsi Mashinini. I'm like, this is crazy. You understand? But guess what? Not no more. We're going to sing aloud. We're going to make known that what the unsung heroes of our people. Who Tsietsi Mashinini, they're going to know about that. You understand? Because our enemies don't want to know about people like that. We're going to make sure that they are known this day. Understand that. Now, give me the book of Lamentations 4, verse 18. Lamentations chapter 4, verse 18. Okay, read that for me.
The book of Lamentations chapter 4, verse 18.
Read.
They hunt our steps.
They do what?
They hunt our steps.
Because during the time when the police opened fire on unarmed students, they were hunting our steps with their guns. Go ahead.
That we cannot go in our streets.
We cannot go in our streets. Because the students, they went to the street. They took to the street to protest against Africans. But the Buddhists, they hunted our steps. They opened fire with live bullets to slaughter our young men and young women. Go ahead.
Our end is near.
Mm-hmm.
Our days are fulfilled.
Go ahead.
For our end is come.
Our end is come because they slaughtered many students on that day. Next verse. Watch this.
Our persecutors are swifter than the eagles of the heaven.
You see that thing? Because it says, the Lord says, I'm going to send a nation against you from far, as swift as the eagle flyer. That's what we're reading here. Our persecutors or our possessors that hold themselves not guilty, it says they are swifter than the eagles of the heaven. They prey upon the nation. They prey upon the people. They prey upon the inhabitants that they conquer. Go ahead.
They pursued us upon the mountains.
You see that? Read.
They laid wait for us in the wilderness.
You see that thing to do what? To destroy us. Give me that in Psalms chapter 10, verse 8. Psalms 10, verse 8. Okay, because King David, he talked about this thing as well. Read that.
The book of Psalms chapter 10, verse 8.
Come on.
He sitteth in the lurking places of the villages.
You know what? Start of this one. We're going to jump.
The book of Psalms, chapter 10, verse 1.
Read.
Why standest thou afar off, O Lord?
Mm-hmm.
Why hidest thou thyself in times of trouble?
Because during that time, 1976, it was the time of trouble. So it is today. We are still in that time of trouble. You understand? The time of trouble has not ended. We are now going to see more trouble that will come upon Jacob. Read.
The wicked in his pride doth persecute the poor.
The wicked is the white man, the Boers on this side of the earth that came here in 1652 with their father Jan van Riebeck. The wicked in their pride, they persecute the poor. The young students during the Soweto uprising, that's what they did. They persecuted us. Go ahead.
Let them be taken in the devices that they have imagined.
You know what the Lord says? He's gonna judge them. Jump down to verse 8. Read.
The book of Psalms, chapter 10, verse 8.
Come on.
He sitteth in the lurking places of the villages.
This white man, he says, he sitteth in the lurking places of the villages. They are in our castes now. Because when we went to Vilakazi, listen, I don't know how many white people have seen. White people and their children, they came there, it's like they're at home. Making uncomfortable in our own neighborhood. You cannot make it up. You understand? The Arabs also, they are there. You see Arab women with expensive cars. They're roaming in the castes like it's normal. And when we teach in the same castes, the black woman says, we're teaching apartheid, we're teaching hate. You cannot make it up. Read again verse 8.
The book of Psalms of the 10 verse 8.
Read.
He sitteth in the lurking places of the villages.
Mm-hmm.
In the secret places doth he murder the innocent.
You see what they did? In the secret places doth he murder the innocent. The young students that protested because the villages is the castle. The villages is the castles and the rural areas. It says what? It says in the secret places that we murder the innocent because they come and invest in caste economy. That's what they do. Ray.
His eyes are privily set against the poor.
You see that thing? They are private. He says their eyes are privately set against the poor. That's the same thing that Habakkuk said. You understand? It says they want to devour the poor secretly. Ray.
He lieth in wait secretly as a lion in his den.
Ray.
He lieth in wait to catch the poor.
You see that thing? They do it secretly. But during 1976, they did it publicly. The public massacre of the innocent students that were protesting peacefully. Right?
He doth catch the poor.
Mm-hmm.
When he draweth him into his net.
You see that thing? The net was the guns that they were shooting our sons with. Right?
He croucheth and humbleth himself. That the poor man fall by his strong ones.
That the poor may fall by his strong ones. You see what he's saying? After he do all this evil, he says they crouch and humble themselves. You know what they say? They say Jesus loves you. They teach you Christianity and give you white Jesus. You see that thing? He humbled himself. He crouches and humbled himself that the poor may fall by his strong ones. What is the strong one? Their instrument, Christianity, politics, democracy, rainbow nation. That's how they destroy it. You understand? That's how they do it. Okay? Now, watch this. Give me the book of Nehemiah. Go back to Nehemiah 9, verse 27.
The book of Nehemiah, chapter 9, verse 27.
Read.
Therefore, thou deliverest them into the hand of their enemies, who vexed them. And in the time of their trouble, when they cried unto thee, thou heardest them from heaven. And according to thy manifold mercies, thou gavest them saviors.
Mm-hmm.
Who saved them out of the hand of their enemies?
You see, the saviors. My Tsietsi Mashinini was a savior. We need to understand that thing. We need to teach our children that he was one of the saviors. Okay? Now watch this. Go back to the article. As president, read that.
As president of the SSRC, Mashinini issued many press statements on behalf of the organization and the largest student body.
Go ahead.
He called for unity, class boycotts, stayaways, and disseminated information.
Go ahead.
But he also used the platform to attack the state.
You see what they are saying? They are lying. He did not attack the state. They are lying here. Tsietsi Mashinini did not attack the state. He just spoke truth, and they hated him for that. Go ahead.
Reacting to the state's violence against the masses.
Read.
In response to the shootings of June 16, he said, we see it as an official declaration of war on the black students by our peace officers.
You see that thing? Because it was a declaration of war. When they opened fire on innocent, unarmed students, it was a declaration of war on black students. Why? Because what they were teaching was the truth. They were speaking truth to power, and they got persecuted for that. Okay, go ahead.
Mashinini became an enemy of the system.
Stop right there. Mashinini did what?
Mashinini became an enemy of the system.
He became the enemy of the state. Mashinini became the enemy of the state. Why? Because he spoke the truth. Give me Galatians 4 verse 16. Okay. Mashinini became the enemy of the state because he spoke truth to power. Guess what? We are the enemy of the state, brother. I hope you understand that. We are the enemy of the state because we speak truth to power as it is written. Read that Galatians 4, verse 16.
The book of Galatians, chapter 4, verse 16.
Read.
Am I therefore become your enemy? Because I tell you the truth.
You see that? Am I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? That's exactly what became of him. When he spoke the truth to power, he became the enemy of the state. Because they keep saying the enemy of the system. No, no, no. The state. Because the previous paragraph says he attacked the state. He did not attack the state. But the state made it seem like now, because he's speaking the truth, he's speaking against the government. And he became the enemy of the state. Understand that. Read that again.
Mashinini became an enemy of the system.
He became the enemy of the system, meaning the enemy of the state. Read.
And in particular, the hostile dwellers.
No. Because listen, who was the people that was having problem with what Mashinini and the students did? It wasn't the people that dwelt in hostels. It was the government. The Bure apartheid government, they are the ones that had a problem with what he did. Remember, I don't know if you brothers, when we were teaching there next to the statue, at the bottom there, they wrote what he did, and they put quote unquote his crime there. They say he became the enemy of the what? Of the apartheid government. He became the leader of the student uprising. Therefore, that made him the enemy of the state. That was written down there on the statue. You understand? So read that again.
Mashinini became an enemy of the system.
Mm-hmm.
And in particular, the hostile dwellers.
They are lying. Go ahead.
The police frequently converged on his home in an attempt to arrest him.
Go ahead.
On two occasions, he came dressed in a female outfit and eluded arrest.
Read.
Becoming the most wanted man in the country.
You cannot make this up. He became the most wanted man in the country because he spoke truth to power. And he didn't have the scriptures with him. Now imagine now what's going to happen to us, brother. I hope you understand that. Go ahead.
The police offered a 500 rand reward for anyone who could supply information that would lead to his arrest.
You see that thing? Now they were paying our people off to let him out. Give me that in Deuteronomy 27, because that's against the law to do that. Okay. Deuteronomy 27, read verse 25. Watch this.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 27, verse 25.
Read.
Cursed be he that taketh reward to slay an innocent person.
Mm-hmm.
And all the people shall say, Amen.
You see, the white, you think the white man don't know this? He knows this. So when he was offering reward, anybody that can find Tsietsi Mashinini, he knew that would be making that brother break the law. They knew that. They know that. Okay. Keep going. Read on the article.
A colonial visor of the Soweto CID made an appeal to Mashinini to hand himself over, saying he risked being killed by angry hostile dwellers who were antagonized by the recent unrest.
You see that? They're lying. It says that, you see, the colonel, this white man, he was telling the people, saying, listen, you are risking of being killed by angry hostel dwellers who were antagonized by the recent unrest. They're lying. The black people were not antagonized. The Burans were antagonized. That's why they opened fire. What are they talking about? Go ahead.
Visor further said it would be best if his parents brought him to the police station.
Now they are getting desperate. They are going to the parents to say, listen, you must convince your son to hand himself over. Go ahead.
We believe that Mashinini is active and moving about Soweto and other townships.
Stop right there. You see that part right there? We believe that Mashinini is active. What does that mean? Meaning what? He's still pushing away with Africans away. He's mobilizing the people. He's active. So that is the problem. The problem was that they were afraid that he was active, mobilizing other people, other students to continue, even after he's gone. You see that? Go ahead.
We believe that Mashinini is active and moving about Soweto and other townships, but we have never been able to locate him.
You see that part? He is active and he's moving about Soweto and other townships. Meaning what? He's gathering more people. No, they are teaching here. They are teaching that place. They are going around the country to teach the gospel. You see that? I hope you men can see that. I hope you men can see that thing. Go ahead.
If you spot him or know where he is, you must report him to the nearest police, said Visor.
You see that thing? So this demonic Edomite was rallying our people, you understand? The coon, you understand? The red, to find him out. Watch this. Now read that.
The intense scrutiny compelled Mashinini to flee the country.
You see what happened? Now, before we get there, I'm going to show you something. This paragraph right here, the reason why this colonel was moving up the way that he was moving, it was because of fear. Give me that in Revelation 11, verse 8. Revelation chapter 11, verse 8. I'm going to show you why he was moving the way he was moving. He was getting desperate. You understand? That's why he was worried that his active is moving and he's going to other townships to do what? To do the same thing that he did in Naledi and where? And is it Morris Isaacson or Isaac Morrison? Which one is it? I keep confusing it. Isaac Morrison, yeah? Or Morris Isaacson?
Morris
Isaacson. Okay, my apologies, brother. Morris Isaacson. Okay, read that. Revelation 11, verse 8.
The book of Revelation, chapter 11, verse 8.
Go ahead.
And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of the great city.
Because guess what? When they massacred the students, guess what? They were happy about that. Their dead bodies shall lie in the streets of the great city. Go ahead.
Which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt.
Spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt. Because in Egypt, guess what we were? We were slaves in Egypt. We are now under spiritual Egypt. We are still slaves. Go ahead.
Where also our Lord was crucified.
Because the image and the teachings of our Lord and Savior was crucified here in the country, under America. Okay, go ahead.
And they of the people and kindreds and tongues and nations shall see their dead bodies 3 days and a half,
mm-hmm.
and shall not suffer their dead bodies to be put in graves.
Because guess what? The Buddhists were afraid. The enemies are always afraid when they see our people waking up spiritually and mentally, being conscious of who they are, and be able to come together. That makes the people nervous. I remember there was a time in this country where Julius Malema met with Jacob Zuma. And guess what? E! News was in an uproar. You understand? The news media were in an uproar trying to figure out what is Jacob Zuma and Julius Malema talking about. Why? Because our unity, it makes them fearful. Our unity makes them nervous. That's why even in the workplace, they want us to speak English, they say, because they are worried they might be planning something. Understand that. Go ahead.
And they that dwell upon the earth shall rejoice over them.
They that dwell upon the earth is the nations, the people, the kindreds, the tongues, and nations is the other nations that are working together to keep us at the bottom. It says, they that dwell upon the earth, the nations, they rejoice over us being dead and not remembering who we are, lost and confused. Go ahead.
And make merry.
That's what Merry Christmas, that's what Christmas is all about. That's what Valentine's Day, Mother's Day and all, it's all about that. They are celebrating the destruction of the black man and the black woman. Go ahead.
And shall send gifts one to another.
You see that they're sending gifts one to another. And the gifts for the children that they enslaved and snatched from their mothers. Really?
Because these two prophets tormented them that dwelt on the earth.
The two prophets is Judah and Israel. Northern kingdom, southern kingdom. That's the two prophets. Okay, go ahead.
And after 3 days and a half, the spirit of life from God entered into them.
Go ahead.
And they stood upon their feet.
Wait.
And great fear fell upon them which saw them.
You see that thing? It says after 3 days and a half, after 350 years, meaning what? Because the truth started to be become more prevalent in the 60s on up. 1960 and on up, that was when the nation, that our people started to wake up that we are the Israelites. That's why the Buddhists on this side, they were very hard on the black man. And on in the Americas, Jim Crow, the Jim Crow laws was very hard on the black man over there, the tribe of Judah. Just like they were hard on us on this side, the tribe of Judah, with apartheid regime. That's why when students like Tsietsi, Mashinini rose up, it made them even more nervous. Because why? The white man knew that it's time for the black man to wake up to who he is. So we need to make sure that we are hard on the black man. Because if the black man wakes up to this Bible, it's done. It's a wrap. That's why they responded the way that they did when the student protested, because they understood the prophecy in Deuteronomy 28 verse 49. They understood that. Don't get it twisted. They understood that. I'm going to show you that. Get that in Genesis 49 verse 8. He said, because great fear fell upon them which saw them. Because this is in a process of time. Before we could wake up to who we are, the Most High God, he did what? He had to make sure that we start to do what? Judah starts to wake up by finding out who he is, his identity. And he's going to start to confront the enemy to his face. That's what Tsietsi Mashinini did against the apartheid regime. Get that in Genesis 49 verse 8. Read that.
The book of Genesis, chapter 49 verse 8.
Go ahead.
Judah, thou art he whom thy brethren shall praise.
Wait.
Thy hand shall be in the neck of thine enemies.
You see that thing? The hand of Judah, the so-called Bantu, the so-called Negro. It says Judah, the Negro, the Bantu and the Negro, guess what? They are the ones who will be in the neck of their enemy. Meaning what? They'll be going head to head, toe to toe with the enemy in politics. You understand? Going toe to toe with the enemy, trying to fight, try to fight for the rights of the people, to deliver the people from oppression. That's what Tsietsi Mashinini did in the student. Okay, read.
Thy father's children shall bow down before thee.
Meaning what? The other tribes are going to see that, listen, the black man is rising up. And that's what the white man is afraid of. You understand? Go ahead. Verse 9. Read.
Judah is a lion's whelp.
Mm-hmm.
From the prey, my son, thou art gone up.
From the prey, my son, thou art gone up. Go ahead. Meaning a young, ferocious, powerful lion. That's what Tsietsi Mashinini was. Go ahead.
He stooped down.
Mm-hmm.
He couched as a lion.
He says he stooped down, meaning ready to pounce, ready to devour the enemy. You understand? He couched as a lion. Go ahead.
And as an old lion, who shall rouse him up?
Because Judah became old, half, by what? Politics, democracy, integration, feminism. That's what destroyed, because it seems like Judah is going to do something. When, during 1960, here in the country, you understand, with the Sharpeville massacre, look at the way the white men responded when we said, we don't want the dog pass no more. You see the way they responded? Because they knew that was the time for Judah to wake up. That's why they opened fire on mothers and fathers and children, and they were running away from bullets, and they were unarmed. 16 years later, they did the same thing during the Soweto massacre, because they knew that was the time for Judah to wake up. That's why they responded the way that they did. Read again verse 9. Come on.
Genesis chapter 49 verse 9.
Mm-hmm.
Judah is a lion's whelp, and from the prey, my son, thou art gone up.
Come on.
He stooped down. He couched as a lion.
Mm-hmm.
And as an old lion, who shall rouse him up?
Because integration is what made Judah to be old. You understand? Because why? Integration, feminism, in rainbow nation, we are all one and all that. White Jesus, Christianity, that's what destroyed the black man. You understand? So now, but during this time, Judah was regaining identity. You understand? And that's what put fear on the white man. And who was going to raise Judah up? The Most High God and his son, Jesus the Christ. Give me 2 Exodus chapter 13. No, 2 Exodus chapter 11. 2 Exodus chapter 11, and verse 37. Watch this.
Second book of Exodus, chapter 11, verse 37.
Read.
And I beheld, and lo, as it were a roaring lion chased out of the wood.
This roaring lion is talking about Judah, the Messiah, first and foremost, because he's from the tribe of Judah. And Judah will be risen up first. Go ahead.
And I saw that he sent out a man's voice unto the eagle and
he
said.
The man's voice. So this lion had a man's voice. Which man is this? Christ first and foremost. The eagle is talking about who? The Buddha. You understand? America. The white man. So-called Esau, Edom, Iduni. Go ahead.
And said, hear thou, I will talk with thee, and the highest shall say unto thee.
So now this lion that had a man's voice and spoke to the eagle, the voice is the word of God. Because who will raise Judah up? Christ will raise Judah up. Get that in Zechariah 12 and 7.
The book of Zechariah, chapter 12, verse 7.
Read.
The Lord also shall save the tents of Judah first.
You see that? The Lord will save the tents of Judah first. Like a lion chased out of the wood, and out of this lion, guess what? He had a man's voice unto the eagle. The voice is the word of God. Go ahead.
That the glory of the house of David and the glory of the inhabitants of Jerusalem do not magnify themselves against Judah.
So the Lord says he will raise Judah first. He will raise Judah first. When Judah rises up, Judah will take it to the streets. Get to Deuteronomy 33, verse 7. Judah will go to the streets to wake the people up. And guess what? Tsietsi Mashinini was moving in the same spirit. The only thing he did not have in his hand was the Holy Scriptures. But he had the history. Okay, read.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 33, verse 7.
Read.
And this is the blessing of Judah. And he said, hear, Lord, the voice of Judah, mm-hmm. and bring him unto his people.
You see that thing? The voice of Judah, like what? Like as a lion chased out of the wood. The voice of Judah is the word of God. You understand? But before Judah can get the word of God, Judah will try to what? To use things like politics? To use things like what? Black consciousness movement? You understand? The civil rights movement to wake up the people. Because Judah then will be regaining identity. On this side under apartheid, on that side under Jim Crow. Read.
Let his hands be sufficient for him.
Mm-hmm.
And be thou an help to him from his enemies.
You see that thing? Thou art he whom thy brethren shall praise. Thy hand shall be in the neck of thine enemies to help Judah, to help the people. And that's what the Lord did with Tsietsi Mashinini. He's one of the saviors. We must honor that brother, okay? Because what he did, he loved the people. Even with the little that he had, he, guess what? He used what he had for the benefit of the 12 tribes of Israel. So we must honor him, okay? Understand that. Watch this. Go back to Revelation 11, verse 11.
Revelation chapter 11, verse 11.
Read.
And after 3 days and a half, the spirit of life from God entered into them, mm-hmm. and they stood upon their feet, and great fear fell upon them which saw them.
You see what put fear on these nations? When we wake up and gather the people together, and more so when we come in the name of the Lord, listen, it paralyzes the nations. The nations become paralyzed when we do that. Now, let's go back. He says, Mashinini became the what? Where is that when he says he became the enemy of the state? Yes, we read that, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, obedience to the Lord. Yes. Now, read that. The intense scrutiny. Now, I want you to read that now.
The intense scrutiny compelled Mashinini to flee the country.
Mm-hmm.
He left the country for Botswana in August 1976.
So now they are forcing him to flee the country. You would think that his own brothers will be protecting him. Meaning what? The so-called, we are fighting the struggle. The struggle fighters, right? Read that part again.
The intense scrutiny compelled Mashinini to flee the country.
Now, I want you to read between the lines. Now, I want you to read this. Read this paragraph right here. Watch this.
The events of 16 June 1976 mm-hmm. So large numbers of youth joining the ranks of the African National Congress, ANC, and its military wing, Umkhonto weSizwe, MK.
Wait.
Eventually leading to more vigorous mass action and international boycotts against apartheid in South Africa.
Now, I want you to read between the lines, right? Because what you see in here, you see, you must understand how our enemies write things. You see, they are mentioning this, right? They said the events of 1976 is that there was a large number of the youth joining the ranks of the ANC, the MK, Umkhonto weSizwe, you understand? But watch the next part of that paragraph. Read that.
The intense scrutiny compelled Mashinini to flee the country.
Stop right there. Anybody see anything wrong with this? Some heavy stuff right there. Because I was talking to Ngala here. And he said something, because there's certain things that you're not going to read on the internet. The people that were on the ground, they know the history. You understand? And he was telling me, he said, listen, they were interviewing Tsietsi Mashinini, and they were asking him regarding the victories and the protests that they were doing. And they asked him about the ANC. And he said, he's not the member of the ANC. And ANC was not responsible for this. You understand? And they denounced that brother. That's what he said. He was telling me that they denounced the brother. He became enemy number one. When he said he's not the member of the ANC, because why? ANC wanted to ride on the wave of what Tsietsi Mashinini and the students did. So they wanted to what? They wanted to steal his thunder. Anybody know what, you understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
That's why, read the next paragraph. What did he say?
The intense scrutiny compelled Mashinini to flee the country.
Why would he flee the country if you've got your brothers that are with you that are going to protect you from all this? You see this? Hold that. Give me John 11, verse 47. I'm going to show you the same thing that they did to Tsietsi Mashinini is the same thing that the scribes and Pharisees was doing to our Lord and Savior, the Messiah. Watch this. John chapter 11, verse 47.
The book of John, chapter 11, verse 47.
Go ahead.
Then gathered the chief priests and the Pharisees a council and said, What do we? For this man doeth many miracles.
You see that thing? What are we going to do? The scribes and Pharisees is the what? The quote-unquote politicians and the pastors who don't care about their people. They gathered, they had a council. They said, listen, this guy is causing too many problems for us. We want integration, he wants separation. He's causing too many problems for us. You see that thing? That's the mindset of Democrats, okay? The religion of the Greeks. Go ahead.
If we let him thus alone, all men will believe on him.
If we leave him alone, if we allow him to continue this, all the students will believe on him. That's what Colonel Caesar said, and that's why his brothers denounced him. Go ahead.
And the Romans shall come and take away both our place and nation.
That's why when we were teaching at Villagazi Street, they said, we're making white people uncomfortable when we teach that Jesus is a black man. God has bled, the Israelites are bred, we are teaching apartheid. That's the same thing. That is the same mindset. Because those that speak truth to power, nobody talks about them. You understand? That's why Tsietsi Mashinini, even the children don't know who he is. You see this thing? Read again, verse 48. Because why? Because they are backed up by Rome. They are backed up by America and Europe. You understand? When you speak like that, you're going to scare away the investor. Isn't that Cyril Ramaphosa is fond of saying? Read again, verse 48.
The book of John, chapter 11, verse 48.
Go ahead.
If we let him thus alone, all men will believe on him.
Mm-hmm.
And the Romans shall come and take away both our place and nation.
You see that thing? Because why? Because he was speaking truth to power. That's what Christ was doing. He was speaking truth to power. What was the power back then? The Roman Empire. You understand? Tsietsi Mashinini, what was he speaking against during his last days? He was speaking against the apartheid regime. The same thing. Now give me Acts 4, verse 11. Because after Christ left, the time of the Acts of the Apostles, which is we are living in those times now, here's what happened. Acts 4, verse 11. The same scribes and Pharisees They were now going against the apostles after Christ, or when Christ was gone. Watch this. Read it.
The book of Acts, chapter 4, verse 11.
Go ahead.
This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders.
The scribes and Pharisees, that's the builder. Read.
Which has become the head of the corner.
Become the head of the corner. That's the same thing the apostle Peter said. Go ahead.
Neither is there salvation in any other.
Mm-hmm.
For there is none other name under the heaven given among men, whereby we must be saved.
Because we're going to be saved under the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Keeping the commandments in the faith of Christ. Okay, go ahead.
Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John,
mm-hmm.
and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they
marveled. That's how they look at it. That's how they look at it. They say we are unlearned and we are ignorant men. Because the brother said, when we ate Vilagasi, he said, but why do you have to teach us like this? Because these things, nobody taught the Bible like this. Why do you have to teach it like this? The image of the beast, Jesus is blessed. He was upset about that. Go ahead.
They marveled. They took knowledge of them,
mm-hmm.
that they had been with Jesus.
They took knowledge of us that these are the acts of the apostles are back on this earth. They understood that although they hate our God, but they understand these are moving in the spirit of Christ right here. Go ahead.
And beholding the man which was healed, standing with them, they could say nothing against it.
Because they saw the people coming to learn the gospel. Read.
But when they had commanded them to go aside out of the council,
mm-hmm.
they conferred among themselves.
They conferred among themselves, the scribes and Pharisees, go ahead.
Say, what shall we do to these men?
That's the same thing that they were doing to us in Gilagasi. Go ahead. And in Shabbir. Read.
For that indeed a notable miracle has been done by them is manifest to all mm-hmm. them that dwell in Jerusalem. And we cannot deny it.
You see that even the white people could not deny what we were teaching. When we were teaching the gospel in Vilagasi Street this past weekend, even our enemies could not deny the truth that was coming out at the Bible. Read. And the black woman was amazed by that. She didn't like that. Read.
But that it spread no further among the people. Let us straightly threaten them.
You see that? Let us straightly threaten them. Isn't that what they were doing? They were threatening us. Go ahead.
That they speak henceforth to no man in this name.
You see that thing? That we speak no more in the name of the Lord. We must not teach that black Jesus stuff. That's what they say. You understand? But we're going to continue. The mission is a go. Give me Acts 17 verse 3. Acts chapter 17 verse 3. Because whenever the truth is spoken, that's why they call Tsietsi Mashinini the enemy of the state. Okay? Read that. Acts 17 verse 3. Watch this.
Acts chapter 17 verse 3.
Read.
Opening and alerting.
That, you know what? Start of his two.
The book of Acts, chapter 17, verse 2.
Read.
And Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and three Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the scriptures.
We reasoned out of the scriptures as the apostle Paul did. Go ahead.
Opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus, whom I preached unto you, is Christ.
We're teaching the black Messiah as it is written. Go ahead.
And some of them believed and consorted with Paul and Silas.
Mm-hmm.
And of the devout Greeks, a great multitude. And of the chief women, not a few.
So there are those that believe and know that what we're bringing out is the truth and nothing but the truth. But there are those that don't believe. Watch this. Go ahead.
But the Jews which believe not.
But our people which don't believe, who hate themselves and hate the black Messiah in the Bible. Go ahead.
Moved with envy.
Mm-hmm.
Took unto them certain lewd fellows of the baser sort.
Meaning grimy brothers, grimy sisters who hate the Bible, who hate law and order. They were moved with envy because who did they envy? Hold that. Give me Proverbs 3:31. They were moved with envy. Who are they envying? I'm going to show you who they envy. Because when we teach that Jesus is black, they say we're making white people uncomfortable. Proverbs 3:31. Read that.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 3, verse 31.
Go ahead.
Envy thou not the oppressor,
mm-hmm.
and choose none of his ways.
You see that? So when it says the Jews which believe not were moved with envy, the envy of the oppressor. They envy the oppressor so much so that they will sell and turn against their own people to what? To make the oppressor feel comfortable in his kingdom. You understand? Oppressing us. Oppressing their own people. You understand? And that's what we saw. And it's mainly the black woman and the simp men that follow behind the black woman. Give me James 3 verse 14. Okay? James 3 verse 14. Envy of the oppressor. Okay?
Book of James chapter 3 verse 14.
Go ahead.
But if ye have bitter envying and strife in your hearts,
you see that envy of the oppressor, that bitter envy of the oppressor, it causes strife. That's why that black woman with the blonde hair who got cut when we're reading about blonde hair, guess what? She was causing strife on the street, railing the simple men and the Jezebel women to go against us. You see that? Go ahead.
The book of James chapter 3 verse 14.
Read.
But if you have bitter envying and strife in your hearts, glory not, and lie not against the truth.
Because they were lying against the truth that we were breaking out. Read verse 16. Go ahead.
Verse 16.
Mm-hmm.
For where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work.
That's exactly what took place when we were at Vilagazi Street in Soweto. And that's what happened here in Acts. Go back to Acts 17, verse 5. You know what? Give me the book of Wisdom of Solomon 2, 24. Wisdom of Solomon 2, verse 24. I'm going to show you something.
Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 24.
Go ahead.
Nevertheless, through envy of the devil came death into the world.
You see that? Through envy of the devil came death into the world. Who envied the devil? Our foremother Eve. That was the Jews that did not believe. Meaning what? They don't believe that Jesus is a black man. They were moved with envy because they envied the oppressor. You understand? And who envied the oppressor? The black woman primarily, followed by the black man. Because the black man that is a simp, that worships the woman, they are the ones that follow behind the woman. They also have a problem with the image of Christ in the Bible as a black man. You understand? Go ahead.
And they that do hold of his side do find it.
Though they that do hold of his side, meaning what? Envy, they find it. You understand? Give me that in Isaiah 25, verse 24. Watch this.
The book of Ecclesiasticus, chapter 25, verse 24.
Read.
Of the woman came the beginning of sin.
Mm-hmm.
And through her, we all die.
You see that? Of the woman came the beginning of sin, and through her, we all die. Why? Because of envy of the oppressor. Listen, I tell you, our sisters, man, listen, sisters, you need to get your mind right, okay? Now, go back to Acts 17, verse 5. Because, I mean, I'm going to tell you, what you want to notice is that because of democracy, Christianity, white Jesus, rainbow nation, you understand, is the reason why you see our people were still destroyed. You understand? Feminism is part of why we're still destroyed as a nation right now. Because why? We've left our first love, which is God's commandment for us to rule the earth. Read that. Acts 17, verse 5. Read.
The book of Acts, chapter 17, verse 5.
Mm-hmm.
But the Jews, which believe not, moved with envy, took unto them certain lewd fellows of the baser sort,
mm-hmm.
and gathered a company, and set all the city on an uproar, and assaulted the house of Jason, and sought to bring them out to the people.
That's exactly what happened to us. Guess what? That's why our forefather Tsietsi Mashinini had to flee the country. You see that? Go ahead.
And when they found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren unto the rulers of the city, saying, crying, these that have turned the world upside down are come hither also.
You see that thing? Because they are saying we are turning the world upside down. We're teaching hate. We're teaching apartheid. We're making white people uncomfortable. That's what the black woman said, and the black man who follows behind. Read.
Whom Jason hath received.
Mm-hmm.
And these all do contrary to the decrees of Caesar.
You see that thing? And these all do contrary to the decree of Caesar. Because why? John 19 verse 15 real quick. They will say, we teach him contrary to Caesar Borgia. Read that. John 19 verse 15.
Book of John, chapter 19, verse 15.
Go ahead.
But they cried out, Away with him. Away with him. Crucify him. Pilate said unto them, shall I crucify your king? The chief priest answered, we have no king but Caesar.
You see that thing? Go back. We have no king. We don't know that black. We don't want that black Jesus of the Bible. We want this white image of Jesus because we envy the white man. Go back to where it was at. Acts 17. Read verse 7 again.
The book of Acts chapter 17 verse 7.
Read.
Whom Jason hath received. And these all do contrary to the decrees of Caesar.
Mm-hmm.
Saying that there is another king, one Jesus.
So they are slandering us now. You understand? That's why our forefather he had to flee the country. You understand? Go ahead.
And they troubled the people and the rulers of the city when they heard these things.
You see that? It says, we troubling the city and the rulers of the people. The politicians, the investors, Kovilakazi, the white people, the Arabs, the Chinese that come to invest over there. When we teach the truth of what happened to them, I mean, the sisters, they went as far as to say, but why do you have to show what happened on June 15? Why do you have to show the pictures of what happened to us? I'm like, this, that's our history. That's the truth. The black woman said, hell to the no, to hell with that. He says, these pictures, they're making white people uncomfortable. You cannot make this up. You understand? Now, give me the book of Esther, chapter 13, verse 3. Esther, in the Apocrypha. Chapter 13, verse 3. Watch this.
The book of Esther, chapter 13, verse 3.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when I asked my counselors how this might be brought to pass, a man that excelled in wisdom among us, and was approved for his constant goodwill and steadfast fidelity, and had the honor of the second place in the kingdom.
So now this is the king of Persia, okay? When Esther, our foremother, was the queen of Persia. So Haman was the second in command to the king of Persia. So he wanted, because he hated the Jews, because our forefather Mordecai did not want to bow down to him. Now he wanted to get all the Jews be put to death because our forefather Mordecai did not want to bow down to him. Now he's coming before the king to slander us. Ray, watch this. Go ahead.
Declared unto us that in all nations throughout the world, there was scattered a certain malicious people.
You see what he's saying? He says we're malicious. We're scattered throughout the earth. Go ahead.
That had laws contrary to all nations.
He says our laws are contrary to all nations because we don't follow the customs of the other nations. We have not assimilated. Ray.
And continually despise the commandments of kings.
Meaning what? We don't want to bow down. Like Tsietsi, Mashinini said, whenever you speak against the government, you are a communist, of course. That's what he said. Read.
So as the uniting of our kingdoms, honorably intended by us, cannot go forward.
He says we cannot move forward because this man is causing problems in the community. He's active and he's moving in other townships to rally the people. Go ahead.
Seeing then, we understand that this people alone is continually in opposition unto all men.
You see that? Read.
Differing in the strange manner of their laws.
The commandments that was given to us, read.
And evil affected to our state.
Mm-hmm.
Working all the mischief they can, that our kingdom may not be firmly established.
You see that? So now he's slandering us before the king of Persia. So what did we become back then? Enemies of the state. What did Tsietsi Mashinini become? He became the enemy of the state because he spoke truth to power. Okay. Now read the article. The intense scrutiny. I want you to read that now.
The intense scrutiny compelled Mashinini to flee the country.
Wait.
He left the country for Botswana in August 1976. Okay. Living there for a few months before he proceeded to the west coast of Africa.
He went to the west coast of Africa. Okay, well, remember, when he was reading the history of the oppression of black people on the continent, that's why he also understood that the same struggle that we're having, we're going through in South Africa, we're going through it in Ghana, Guinea, Botswana, so on and so forth. He understood that. Ray.
Heads of states, notably Segou Touré of Ivory Coast.
Segou Touré of Ivory Coast, go ahead.
And African parliamentarians received him.
They received him in the Ivory Coast. Go ahead.
He resided in countries like Nigeria, where he was briefly hosted in the presidential guest house in Lagos.
He was received in Nigeria because that's the same. Also Nigeria, they are oppressed by Britain. Go ahead.
While in exile, Mashinini was interviewed by many media organizations, and he addressed students at universities, revealing the realities of the South African political situation.
You understand? Go ahead, read.
Mashinini finally settled in Liberia.
He went to Liberia. Remember, Liberia, that's where the slaves were brought. Some of the slaves were actually taken back from the Americas and brought back to Liberia. Read.
Mashinini finally settled in Liberia,
mm-hmm.
where he married Wilma Campbell.
Yeah, I think she was some kind of a model or something like that, I think. Go ahead.
The daughter of a parliamentarian in 1978.
Read.
The marriage was blessed with two daughters, Nomkita, named after his mother, and Tembi.
Read.
However, the marriage ended after a few years.
Now watch this. Now, you know, keep going, keep going. Watch this.
Mashinini later visited the United Kingdom and the United States, where he addressed the United Nations on the brutalities of the apartheid regime.
Wait.
By many accounts, Mashinini did not join any of the established liberation movements in exile.
So now, the reason why he fled, you see all these countries, the Ivory Coast, Nigeria, okay, Liberia, okay, UK, the United States, these places that he went to, Botswana, this is where all the children of Israel are scattered. Understand that? You understand? But he fled to these countries. Why? Give me Hosea 8 verse 1. Hosea chapter 8 verse 1. Because he couldn't trust nobody. Even those that looked like him, that tend, you understand, that were being paid behind closed doors to destroy their own brothers. Okay? Because you always had Judas is among us. Hosea 8 verse 1. Go ahead.
The book of Hosea, chapter 8, verse 1.
Come on.
Set the trumpet to thy mouth. He shall come as an eagle against the house of the Lord.
The one that came against the eagle against the house of the Lord, the Buren. Go ahead.
Because they have transgressed my covenant and trespassed against my law.
Go ahead.
Israel shall cry unto me.
Mm-hmm.
My God, we know thee.
Because we were crying unto the Lord. Read on.
Israel hath cast off the thing that is good.
The Bible. From the prey, my son, thou art gone up. Read.
The enemy shall pursue him.
The enemy shall what?
The enemy shall pursue him.
That's why he fled the country, because the enemies were pursuing this brother. Give me Exodus 15, verse 9.
The book of Exodus, chapter 15, verse 9.
Read.
The enemy said, I will pursue.
I will do what?
I will pursue.
The enemy said, I will pursue, I will overtake. Go ahead.
I will divide the spoil.
Mm-hmm.
My lust shall be satisfied upon them.
But them is us. Read.
I will draw my sword.
Mm-hmm.
My hand shall destroy them.
That's the mind of our enemy. And Tsietsi, Mashinini and the students, they all understood who the enemy was and the mindset of the enemy. The proof of that was what? The 1976 massacre of the innocent students that were unarmed, peacefully protesting. Okay? Give me Zechariah chapter 11, verse 5. Go back there again.
The book of Zechariah chapter 11, verse 5.
Go ahead.
Whose possessors slay them and hold themselves not guilty.
Mm-hmm.
And they that sell them say, blessed be the Lord, for I am rich.
Mm.
And their own shepherds pity them not.
Meaning the lead, the so-called leaders, they don't give a damn about their own people. Go back to the article. One of, read that. Tsietsi Mashinini.
Tsietsi Mashinini will always be remembered as a fearless fighter and student leader whose name will forever be etched in memory as one of the outstanding leaders of the South African Revolution.
But our so-called leaders, they don't act like this. They don't act like that because you don't hear about the brother as much. Even the children don't know about the brother. but they know about Hector Peterson, but they don't know about Mwiseni, the brother that was carrying Hector Peterson. Nobody talks about that brother. Don't get it twisted. I'm not saying nobody must remember Hector Peterson. Don't misunderstand. What I'm saying is that, yes, they show the picture, but they don't talk about the sister. They hardly talk about the sister next to Hector Peterson. They hardly talk about the brother that was holding Hector Peterson. Most importantly, they don't even mention this machine at all. You understand? So what they are saying here, it does not equal to what we're seeing in the media. That's the point. Okay? Now, read the next paragraph.
One of Mashinini's admirers was his compatriot, Miriam Makeba.
So Miriam Makeba was Tsietsi Mashinini's, he admired Tsietsi Mashinini. Go ahead. No, Mashinini, yeah. Go ahead.
Who was in exile in Guinea?
He was in exile in Guinea. You see, there's a lot of hidden history that they don't want to talk about in the media. Because we talk about Miriam Makeba, we remember her by, because she was a singer and all that. But there's a lot of history about this our foremother. You understand? We want to talk about her, but not today. Go ahead.
She had offered Mashinini a place to stay in her home in Conakry shortly before his death.
Go ahead.
Mashinini died under mysterious circumstances in 1990.
So Mashinini died in 1990, right? Watch this. Go ahead. In Guinea. Come on.
He was hospitalized for multiple injuries.
So remember now. Because remember, Mashinini was being hunted down. That's what we just read in Exodus 15, verse 9, Zechariah 11, verse 5, Hosea 8, verse 1 through 3. Lamentations 4, verse 18, they hunt our steps. Psalms 10, verse 8 through 10. That's the same thing we read. So don't forget the sword. This man was being hunted down because he says he became the most wanted man in the country. So even when he fled to neighboring African countries, they were still hunting him down. You think the white man did not have allies in these other African countries? Remember, in the 1884, there was the Berlin Conference. You understand? So when they divided Africa up like a piece of cake, give me that in Micah 2 verse 4 real quick. Micah 2 verse 4. Micah 2 verse 2, then we're going to jump to verse 4. Just to show you that, okay? Because we tend to forget that when the white men conquered the continent, they divided the African continent among themselves. But remember, all these white people, they are all the same race. They call themselves by different names, but they are all the sons of Esau. Read that, Micah 2, verse 2.
The book of Micah, chapter 2, verse 2.
Read.
They covered fields and take them by violence and houses. Mm-hmm. And take them away. So they oppress a man and his house, even a man and his heritage.
So they oppress a man, they took our houses by violence, our fields, meaning our land by violence, they oppressed us. You understand? Our houses and our heritage, which is the minerals upon the ground. Go ahead. Verse 4 now.
The book of Micah, chapter 2, verse 4.
Come on.
In that day shall one take up a parable against you.
Because the white man took up a parable against us. Come on.
And lament with a doleful lamentation and say,
Rain.
He be utterly spoiled.
That's what we said. We were utterly spoiled, completely destroyed by the white man. Go ahead.
He hath changed the portion of my people.
Because they took our land and own our resources now. Go ahead.
How hath he removed it from me?
They removed us from our own land. They pushed us into the ghetto, the Bantu stands. Go ahead.
Turning away, he hath divided our fields.
Turning away, when they went back to Europe and all that, America, they divided the continent up for themselves. So that means that in Ghana, Guinea, Nigeria, you understand, Ivory Coast and all that, there's white people over there. The French are over there. In Nigeria, Britain is over there. You see that? So when Tsietsi Mashinini was going to Guinea and all that, guess which white people was over there? The French, the Portuguese. You think they didn't kill the brother? Of course they did. Now read that paragraph again. He was what?
He was hospitalized for multiple injuries, apparently the result of an attack.
You see that? Because remember, the white man has allies on the continent of his own people and of our own people that hate their own people. Read.
He died a few days later. Mashinini's body was terribly disfigured.
I want you to stop right there. Mashinini's body was what?
Mashinini's body was terribly disfigured.
I want you to pay close attention, black men and black women. Is that Mashinini's body was terribly disfigured, just like they did to Tsietsi. You understand? And just like they did to the greatest man that walked this earth. Pay close attention. His body was terribly disfigured. Go ahead.
His left eye had fallen out into his coffin.
You see that? What was they doing to this brother? You don't hear about this thing. Read.
His left ear was bleeding and he had deep bruises on his face.
He had what?
And he had deep bruises on his face.
He had deep bruises. It says his left ear was bleeding and he had deep bruises on his face. On his face. Read.
Including a large scar on his forehead.
Watch this. That means they use a very sharp object to what? To crack his skull out. Give me the book of John 15, verse 18. I want you men to pay attention. You sisters too. John 15, verse 18. Read that.
The book of John, chapter 15, verse 18.
Come on.
If the world hate you, you know that it hated me before it hated you.
You see what Christ is saying? It says, if the world hated you, if the world hates you, you must know that it hated me before it hated you. Go ahead.
If you were of the world would love his own.
If Tsietsi Mashinini did not do what he did, they will love him for that. Go ahead.
But because you are not of the world.
Because Tsietsi Mashinini was not of this world. I need you men to understand that. The Lord says, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy upon. Read.
But I have chosen you out of the world. Therefore, the world hateth you.
Therefore, the world, they hate our God. Go ahead.
Remember the word that I said unto you. The servant is not greater than his Lord.
You see that? The servant is not greater than his Lord. Go ahead.
If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you.
Go ahead.
If they have kept my say, they will keep yours also.
Meaning whatever we teach, whatever Christ taught, they took it to heart, they got offended. Guess what? When we teach as it is written, they also going to get cut. They will get offended. They will keep the things that we say to heart. And they will increase the hatred to do what? To kill us, to persecute us, to follow us from city to city, to want to destroy us. That's what Christ is telling us right here. I want you to see something. Give me the book of Isaiah chapter 52 verse 14. Watch this.
Book of Isaiah, chapter 52, verse 14.
Read.
As many were astonished at thee.
Meaning what? Hold on. As many of the Israelites were astonished at thee. Go ahead.
His visage was so marred more than any man.
You see that thing? When they crucified Christ, when they tortured him, it says his visage, meaning his face, was so marred more than any man. Meaning the way they tortured him, his face, you couldn't tell where his nose was. You couldn't tell where his ears were. You couldn't tell where his eyes were. Read.
And his form more than the sons of men.
Meaning what? Meaning they disfigured his face. Now read that what we just read. Tsietsi Mashinini was what?
He died a few days later. Mashinini's body was terribly disfigured.
You see that? Mashinini's body was terribly disfigured. They're going to tell you how it was disfigured. Go ahead.
His left eye had fallen out into his coffin.
You see that? So his left eye, that's his face. His visage was marred more than any man. Go ahead.
His left ear was bleeding. And he had deep bruises on his face.
His visage was so much more than any man. His form was more than the sons of men. You see that the servant is not greater than his Lord. I want you men to see what's going on here. He is one of the prophets. Understand that. Read again. Mashinini was what?
Mashinini's body was terribly disfigured. His left eye had fallen out of his coffin.
Mm-hmm.
His left ear was bleeding and he had deep bruises on his face.
Read.
Including a large scar on his forehead.
That's what they did to our forefathers, Tsietsi Mashinini. Nobody talks about this thing. Nobody talks about it. They keep parading Mandela all over the place, but nobody talks about this great man that fought for his people. And look at how much he suffered. Isn't the same thing that happened to the Messiah? You don't see that? That's what happened to the black Messiah, Jesus the Christ. Because Tsietsi Mashinini, just like the Messiah, he was a savior. He was one of the saviors. I want you men to understand that thing. Okay? Now, give me Matthew 27, verse 27.
The book of Matthew, chapter 27, verse 27.
Read.
Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the common hall and gathered unto him the whole band of soldiers.
Mm-hmm.
And they stripped him and put on him a scarlet robe.
Stop right there. They did what?
And they stripped him and put on him a scarlet robe.
You know what it means? They stripped him. He was naked. Do you understand that? They took his own clothes off to put a Roman garment on. I need you men and women to understand what's going on. You understand? They stripped him and put on him a scarlet robe. Go ahead.
And when they had plaited a crown of thorns,
they
put it upon his head and a reed in his right hand.
Read.
And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him.
They did what?
Saying. And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him.
They bowed the knee before him and mocked him. They bowed the knee before him and mocked him. Hold this. Give me that in Proverbs 14, verse 9. Proverbs 14, verse 9.
The book of Proverbs, chapter 14, verse 9. Fools make a mock at sin.
You see that? Fools, they make a mock at sin. That's what they were doing to the Messiah. Go ahead.
But among the righteous, there is favor.
But among the righteous, they stay. Go back to where it was at.
The book of Matthew, chapter 27, verse 29.
Read.
And when they had planted a crown of thorns, they put it upon his head, and they reed in his right hand. And they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
And they spit upon him.
They spit upon him. You understand? Because they were disgusted by him. That they, guess what? We disgust them too today when we teach in the name of the Lord. Understand that? Go ahead.
And took the reed and smote him on the head.
You see what they did? They took the reed and smote him. Where did they smite him?
And smote him on the head.
Now go back to the article. I want you to read that thing again. Mashinini, read that part.
Mashinini's body was terribly disfigured. His left eye had fallen out into his coffin. His left ear was bleeding and he had deep bruises on his face, including a large scar on his forehead.
Because why? They took a reed and smote him on the head. Do you see that? I want you men to see what's going on here. Some of you are sleeping up in here. Read again. There is what? It says, including a what on his forehead?
Including a large scar on his forehead.
Go back to Matthew 27, verse 30.
The book of Matthew, chapter 27, verse 30.
Read.
And they spit upon him and took the reed and smote him on the head.
Go ahead.
And after they had mocked him, they took the robe off from him and put his own raiment on him and led him away to crucify him.
You see what they did? So they stripped him naked. They dressed him in a Roman toga. You understand? They put a crown of thorns upon him and they mocked him. After that, they took off the Roman garment and they put on his own raiment on and led him away to crucify. So what were they doing? They were mocking him with a shameful death. That's what they were doing. And that's what they did to our forefather here. These are things that you're not gonna learn about these things if you're not in this truth. You're not gonna learn these things. You understand? Now, read that.
At his funeral service held at the amphitheater stadium in Jabulani, Soweto, former Azanian People's Organization president professor Itumeleng Mosala said, the students of 1976 took the struggle from the classroom to the streets.
Mm-hmm.
The students of today take the struggle from the streets into the classroom.
Vice versa. Because if you think about it, Tsietsi Mashinini was 19 years old, they said. 19 years old, he was already thinking he was nation-minded. But you only look at the 19-year-olds of today, the youth of today, they are bugged out. You know why? Because nobody gives a damn about the youth. The government says we care about the youth, but the youth unemployment is so high. They are not doing nothing for the youth. Don't be fooled, brother. Okay, go ahead.
Leaders of the June 16 uprising spoke in praise of Mashinini.
They did what?
Spoke in praise of Mashinini.
They spoke in praise of Mashinini. Go ahead.
Saying he had made an indelible mark in shaping the history of the country.
Indeed he did. Indeed he did. Go ahead.
The epitaph on his tombstone reads, at the height of struggle, he gave impetus to the liberation struggle.
The deliverance. Liberation means deliverance. Okay, read.
His tombstone at Avalon Cemetery in Soweto was twice vandalized.
You cannot make this up. The man is dead. What are they doing vandalizing his tombstone? What the hell is this? I mean, listen, the man is gone. But look what they're still doing. You see that? Even after he's gone, they are still speaking evil. They still want to do harm to the man. That's why it says, also where our Lord was crucified. Christ is not on this earth right now. But guess what? They are crucifying his image. They are crucifying his teaching too. You see that? The same thing. Go ahead.
His tombstone at Avalon Cemetery in Soweto was twice vandalized and the marble stone was removed.
You cannot make this up. Watch this. Go ahead.
On 27 April 2011, the state president, Jacob G. Zuma, honored Tsietsi Mashinini.
All praise to the Lord for Jacob Zuma to do this thing. All praise to the Most High. Go ahead.
Posthumously, with the Order of Luthuli in gold for his inspirational leadership to young people.
Wait.
For the sacrifices he made while leading students against Afrikaans as a medium of instruction. And for his role in the struggle against apartheid.
That's why they don't like Nsholo. That's why they don't like Jacob Zuma. We understand. We're not confused. We know why they are always accusing the man of evil all the time. We know why. You understand? We know it. So we're not confused. But go back up when it says, they said something there. Read that part right there. It says, leaders of the what? That part.
Leaders of the June 16 uprising spoke in praise of Mashinini,
mm-hmm.
saying he had made an indelible mark in shaping the history of the country.
They spoke in praise of Mashinini. Give me Psalm 44, verse 1. Watch this. Watch how this comes together. Psalm 44, verse 1. Watch this.
The book of Ecclesiasticus, chapter 44, verse 1.
Go ahead.
Let us now praise famous men.
Let us do what?
Let us now praise famous men.
That's the same thing they said. They say they spoke in praise of Mashinini. Read again verse 1.
The book of Ecclesiasticus, chapter 44, verse 1.
Come on.
Let us now praise famous men.
Mm-hmm.
And our fathers that beget us.
And our fathers that beget us. Go ahead.
The Lord has wrought great glory by them through his great power from the beginning.
You see that thing? The Lord wrought great glory by them from the beginning. You understand? Now, jump down to verse 8. Watch this.
The book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 44, verse 8.
You know what? Start at verse 7. Read verse 7.
Verse 7.
You know what? Hold on. Read verse 4.
The book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 44, verse 4.
Come on.
Leaders of the people by their counsels.
You see that? He was a leader of the people. He was a savior. Go ahead.
And by their knowledge of learning meat for the people.
Remember, it says he was a passionate leader. He was passionate about studying the history of his forefathers. That's why it says leaders of the people by their counsel and by their knowledge of learning good for the people. Go ahead.
Wise and eloquent in their instructions.
Wise and eloquent in their instructions. Read verse 7.
Verse 7.
Mm-hmm.
All these were honored in their generations.
Come on.
And were the glory of their times.
They were the glory of their times. So they deserve due honor that is due unto them for putting their lives on the line for the benefit of their people. Go ahead.
There be of them that have left a name behind them that their praises might be reported.
You see that thing? He left a name behind him, but his praises are not reported. The media don't say nothing about our forefathers, Tsietsi, Mashinini. They don't say nothing. Make me sick. But guess what? We're waking up. We want to push this truth out. We want to make sure that these men, these unsung heroes, the world must know about them. Read on.
And some there be which have no memorial,
mm-hmm.
who are perished as though they had never been.
Because the way they deal with our forefathers, it's like, listen, it broke my heart when I hear children say, we don't know anything about the Tsietsi machine. That really broke my heart, man. Go ahead.
And are born as though they had never been born.
You see that? And are become as though they've never been born. Read on.
And are become as though they had never been born. And there are children after them.
Because he had two kids. Okay, next verse. Go ahead. But watch this. Watch what these type of men are. Go ahead.
But these were merciful men.
You see that thing? But these were merciful men. Tsietsi Mashinini was a merciful brother. He saw the condition of his people. He said, listen, I'm going to do something about this thing. Go ahead.
Whose righteousness has not been forgotten.
His righteousness has not been forgotten. You understand? He did the best he could with what he had available to his disposal. Read.
With their seed shall continually remain a good inheritance.
Come on.
And their children are within the covenant.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Their seed standeth fast.
Mm-hmm.
And their children for their sakes.
Come on.
Their seed shall remain forever.
Read.
And their glory shall not be blotted out.
Oh, please. Go ahead.
Their bodies are buried in peace.
Their bodies are what?
Their bodies are buried in peace.
Their bodies are buried in peace. Come on.
But their name liveth forevermore.
But their name does what now?
But their name liveth forevermore.
But their name liveth forevermore. Come on.
The people will tell of their wisdom.
Read.
And the congregation will show forth their praise.
All praises to the Most High God. That's what's going on right now. Read again verse 14.
The book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 44, verse 14.
Mm-hmm.
Their bodies are buried in peace.
Go ahead.
But their name liveth forevermore.
Read.
The people will tell of their wisdom, and the congregation will show forth their praise.
Watch this. Give me Wisdom of Solomon chapter 3, verse 6. Read verse 4. Wisdom of Solomon 3, verse 4. I want you to read Deuteronomy 44, verse 14 again. Deuteronomy 44, verse 14. Read that again.
The book of Ecclesiastes chapter 44, verse 14.
Mm-hmm.
Their bodies are buried in peace.
Read.
But their name liveth forevermore.
Watch this. There are Wisdom of Solomon chapter 3, verse 4 now.
Wisdom of Solomon chapter 3, verse 4.
Mm-hmm.
For though they be punished in the sight of men.
You see that thing? Though they be punished in the sight of men, how he died. You see the way he died? Just like the Messiah. Go ahead.
Yet is their hope full of immortality.
Yet is their hope full of immortality. Come on.
And having been a little chastised.
He was a little chastised because what? He fought for his people. Go ahead.
They shall be greatly rewarded.
He's going to get the kingdom because the Lord says, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy upon. Read.
For God proved them and found them worthy for himself.
Even not having the Holy Scriptures in his head, guess what? He was steadfast for the deliverance of his people from oppression. I want you men to understand that thing. With the Bible, we have the Bible today. Guess what? Laws of excuses. You cannot make this up. Makes me sick to my stomach. Read again. Verse 5.
Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 3, verse 5.
Read.
And having been a little chastised, they shall be greatly rewarded.
Read.
For God proved them and found them worthy for himself.
The Lord proved that brother. He found him worthy for himself. Read.
As gold in the furnace hath he tried them.
Mm-hmm.
And received them as a burnt offering.
He received Tsietsi Mashinini as a burnt offering. You see that thing? All praises to the Most High God for that thing. Now, I'm going to close it up with this video right here. Okay? I'm going to close it up with this video right here.
People passed, people ran away. And this kid innocently raised his fist in a black power sign and said, power to this passing hippo. The hippo stopped there on the spot and they opened fire on this 8-year kid. When I went to the mortuary on the weekend, I saw this kid at the mortuary. She was riddled with bullets beyond recognition. The black student in South Africa is being fed the type of education that will domesticate him to become a better tool for the white man when he joins the working community. School libraries, school books, they've got nothing to do with civics or anything that is affiliated in any manner to politics. What happens is we are fed a lot of fiction stories. I could quote so many authors in fictitious writers that you would be surprised where I get them.
Even because he was a reader. He was a passionate reader.
Our libraries are ill-equipped. You don't get much works on, say, democracy, communism, fascism, capitalism, and all that. We only know these things as concepts and something not within our world.
It's more than likely, Tsietsi, that you're being described up and down the country at the moment as a communist.
There is no truth in that as far as I'm concerned. It is just that in South Africa, if you're not doing what the government expects you to do, then you are a communist, of course.
Mm.
As we interviewed Tsietsi Mashinini, the news came in of how successful the student's plan had been.
It makes me very happy, very happy.
What is it actually achieving, though?
The idea is, we blacks in South Africa do not have arms. And the only thing we can hit at the system with is just to cripple the economy of the country.
Mm. Do you hear that?
Yes,
is it the only way to deal with, to cripple the system is to what? To hit the economy. How can we do that, brother? Hold this. We're coming back to this video. Give me Psalms, okay? Give me Psalm 68, verse 35. This is one of my favorite verses. Watch this. Psalm 68, verse 35. Because the Most High God, he gave us power to collapse the system. Read that. Psalm 68, verse 35. Read that.
The book of Psalms, chapter 68, verse 35.
Read.
O God, thou art terrible out of thy holy places.
Mm-hmm.
The God of Israel is he that giveth strength and power unto his people.
You see that? Go ahead.
Blessed be God.
So the God of Israel is he that giveth strength and power unto his people. The power that God gave us is what? His laws, his statutes, and his commandments. When we keep God's commandments, the sisters, they stop wearing pants. You understand? They start to get married. They stop going to the abortion clinic. The black man stopped taking his pants. He stopped supporting Gillette and all these companies that shall raise us and all that to shave their beards off. You understand? They start supporting them. They stop smoking. They stop supporting Rothmans and Courtly and State Defense. That means the tobacco industry will collapse. You understand? The condom industry will collapse. The pork industry will collapse because we'll start to change our diet. We'll get married. We'll teach our children. You understand? The nations will not longer flood our communities with drugs and guns and alcohol. That means what? We keep the commandments of the Lord. We're not going to break the Sabbath of the Most High God anymore. All these shops that are opening, which is the shops of the other nations, they are all going to get hit. Because we're not going to be spending money on the Sabbath day. That's the power that God gave us. Read again. Verse 35.
Book of Psalms, chapter 68, verse 35.
Read.
O God, thou art terrible out of thy holy places.
Mm-hmm.
The God of Israel is he that giveth strength and power unto his people. Blessed be God.
Oh, baby.
And what is it actually achieving now?
The idea is we blacks in South Africa do not have arms. And the only thing we can hit at the system with is just to cripple the economy of the country and make our faint cries reach the ears of the authorities. Because apparently if we demonstrate, they just shoot at us. And if they don't shoot, they detain a whole lot of students. Now we are trying to be as peaceful as possible, detain the parents at home, and the parents are with us and they are prepared to stay at home as long as the students want them to stay at home. Now, with this, we believe the authorities will feel the pinch, and some way or the other, they'll have to succumb to our demands.
All praises to the Most High. All praises to the Lord. I'm going to end the class right there. All praise to the Most High God. Let's break bread in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as ye drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause, many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep.
In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let's give the Lord a hand for that.